Are you searching for the best in online black radio? Then go to blacktalkradionetwork.com, helping you filter through the noise. Real talk, black talk.
The internet is full of half-truths and all-out lies. We've all seen them, and many people on social media complaining about it. Here's your chance to show and prove. WorldAfropedia.com is a black-owned and operated encyclopedia. There are several thousand articles, but we need help. We can't uncover all the truth ourselves. So please, join us and become a writer, editor, or blogger for WorldAfropedia.com today. Every little bit counts. We owe it to the future generations to put the truth out there. Visit WorldAfropedia.com, the African-centered encyclopedia, a global database of African knowledge for the purpose of bringing about global African wisdom and understanding. WorldAfropedia.com.
That if you want the ultimate expression of white supremacy and the white supremacist mentality, and you want to put it in the form of one person that I would name, and that's something I very seldom do, it would be Jeffrey Dahmer. He's the ultimate expression of white supremacy. Everything that he was doing, working in a chocolate factory, the whole nine yards, and storing black males' bodies in canisters of lye and alcohol and whatnot, and got them in the refrigerator, and cannibalism and all of that, and calm, very methodical. Even when questioned by the law enforcement officers, very calm. Hannibal Lecter, you know. The ultimate. Aryan-looking.
Wasn't he with young boys, too?
Yeah, he was. I mean, I forgot how many bodies. Is, you know, what, you know, something like 20 or something like that. You can probably look it up on the computer. Jeffrey Dahmer, you know. He didn't even try to protect him once he went to prison. He was so embarrassing to everybody, I guess. I mean, you know, everybody who really thinks like he does. They warned him out of the way. But the black guy killed him in prison.
Right. I remember that.
Yeah. See, and I think he was set up to be dead because, you know, he was considered a monster. So he's just as calm as he can be. You know, very methodical, very meticulous, went to work on time, excellent worker, working in a chocolate factory. Looking at chocolate being churned all day. And out there trying to churn chocolate at night. The ultimate expression. Roman Empire. Black death associated. Black. Anti-sex with non-white people associated ultimately with death as being the ultimate. Gather them up, befriend them to the extent that you're saying that, hey, I'm going to take you, a black male, and make you ultimately effeminate, and then kill you. First chance I get.
And he ate them too, didn't he? Wasn't that his thing?
Yes, and eat the bodies, eat the body parts. Got the body parts in wrappers in the refrigerator. And got other body parts, I mean, that he didn't know what to do with, I mean, because he got so many, and got them in big drums full of acid and whatnot. Keep them right there. Not somewhere way out in the woods somewhere. I keep them right there in the apartment. And then go out and gather up some more. I mean, you know, bringing them in one at a time.
Wow.
He probably, you know, you can probably look his name up on the computer and get the whole story. I mean, from A to Z. They've written several books on it and whatnot. I had newspapers and on it and all like that. But that's my statement, that he's the ultimate expression of that type of mentality. Not Adolf Hitler. Jeffrey Dahmer.
Wow.
Right.
Wow.
Because this is what ultimately this white supremacy at its greatest is that. Particularly aiming at the black male. Effeminize the black male and then take him and kill him after that. I mean, not enough just to make him into a thing, but then methodically and with an expression of affection, kill him. Because the black males he was picking up were very trusting of him. Hey, here's a nice white guy. I mean, you know, he's buying me drinks and whatnot, and friendly, and, you know, he ain't calling me nigga and wanting to drag me, by, you know, and burn crosses on my lawn and whatnot. No, he wants to take me to his house. Oh, he's okay. Oh, yeah. It's got to be some reason why a person would even think like that. But the evidence shows that such people do exist.
Context of White Supremacy, Gus T Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Friday, February 3rd, 2017, so I have been told. That was Mr. Neely Fuller Jr. From many years back, giving his thoughts on Jeffrey Dahmer. I think that should be very apparent how and why that applies to the text we are currently reading, the late Vincent Woodard, The Delectable Negro, Human Consumption and Homoeroticism Within U.S. Slave Culture. This is the second book study session. We are picking up on Chapter 1. We only did the introduction last week, so we will get started. I will give Mr. Fuller a plug. ProduceJustice.com, Word Guide, Codebook, excellent setup, right to the text. Vincent Woodard, The Delectable Negro, audio segment number 1.
Cannibalism in Transatlantic Context. In the 18th and 19th centuries, Europeans did not understand the extent to which Western and Central Africans regarded them as cannibals and flesh harvesters. In an 1849 exchange between Agostino, an African-born slave, and the Select Committee of the House of Lords, appointed to consider the best means which Great Britain can adopt for the final extinction of the African slave trade, British interrogators questioned the African man regarding his belief in European cannibalism. British interrogators could not understand what had put the idea into the slaves' heads that they were to be eaten. "Are they eaten in their own country?" asked the British interrogator, as ignorant and suspicious of African as the new slaves were of the white world. In an expected rhetorical maneuver, the interrogator places the onus of proof and explanation on the African man, Agostino. The British man is willing to believe that African culture practices lend themselves to cannibalism, whereas he presumes that civilized European legislative processes, mechanisms of reason, and critical inquiry rise above such a cannibal accusation. Had Agostino truly received the opportunity and felt compelled to explain the particular constellation of beliefs, social practices, human science, and perceptions informing the Africans' belief in white cannibals, members of the select committee would have learned more that day than they probably wanted to know about African notions of Christian cannibalism, slavery as a process of human consumption, and sex and the consumptive appetites of white from African perspectives. The British interrogator asks the African man to speak, to testify before the legislative body, but then renders his voice and perceptual reality, what he might have said about white cannibalism, unspeakable. Rather than inquiring into exactly what the Africans meant by eating and flesh consumption, Europeans and white Americans habitually apply to African persons and cultural practice generic theories of social ineptitude and cannibalistic hunger. For example, in 1839, American media proliferated with images of the Mende persons who had taken over the slave ship Amistad. A number of the Mende men had pointy file teeth and emerged from the slave ship onto American shores wearing no clothing. According to Patricia A. Turner, white Americans equated the African men's pointed teeth and their nakedness with cannibalism. This was an appalling and disturbing lack of modesty as far as white Americans were concerned. In their minds, it made sense that people who were ambivalent about clothing would be the kind to eat human flesh. The Mende, though, had their own ideas about Europeans as cannibals. It was the fear of cannibalistic Europeans that inspired the Mende men to revolt, seize the slave ship, and attempt to sail the vessel back to Sierra Leone. Firmly wedded to rigid notions of their own civility, Europeans have, for the most part, presumed themselves beyond accusations of cannibalism. As we see with the British interrogator, the belief in European supremacy determines the direction and outcome of the exchange. From the outset, the British interrogator interprets any insight Agostino would bring to the topic of Europeans as cannibals as evidence of African cannibalistic ways. In the context of hearings focused on the African person and on ending the slave trade, the last thing British magistrates wanted to discuss was the topic of an emerging European cannibal. They wanted to end the slave trade, absolve their nation of moral taint, and return the Africans to their original status of savagery unless the civilizing efforts of missionaries and other such persons sent to reform the continent of Africa intervened. Taking my cue from this exchange between the British official and Agostino, I explore in this chapter the correlation between the consumptive appetites of whites and the transatlantic slave trade. It is my contention that somewhere between Europe's European denial and African accusation, a new species of civilized white cannibal was born. This white cannibal was unique to the Middle Passage and transatlantic slavery. In addition to literal acts of eating, carving, and cooking flesh, European and American whites developed a culture of cannibalism wherein daily acts of violence, religious conversion, slave seasoning and breaking, and sexual brutality all fed into the master's appetite for African flesh and souls. Many historical texts on the subject of slavery describe the importance of the process of seasoning for breaking men and women and making them into docile slaves. Elaborating on the culinary connotations of the word seasoning, season, to heighten or improve the flavor of food by adding condiments, spices, herbs, or the like, I link the physically brutal culture of seasoning to the parallel development of erotic appetites, tastes, and aesthetic longings for the black male. This broader understanding of seasoning is important, as it helps explain how institutional processes such as Christian indoctrination, male fraternal love and bonding, and the acquisition of literacy facilitated the social consumption of the Negro and the creation of high cultural premium upon African flesh. The textual focus of this chapter is Olauda Equiano's The Interesting Narrative of the Life of Olauda Equiano or Gustavus Vasa, the African, written by himself. We recognize Equiano's text as a staple among transatlantic slave narratives. It was the first to document extensively the experiences and travails of an African Igbo child sold into slavery and shuttled among English, U.S., and Caribbean slave owners. What is still little acknowledged among scholars of Equiano's narrative is how his text documents at length the process of the slave's social consumption, focusing on culinary rituals, processes of flesh seasoning, and the hunger and appetites whites developed for blacks in the context of slave culture. Equiano's text is a useful touchstone for beginning his book-length discussion of homoeroticism and human consumption, as it brings together this culture of consumption with male fraternity and homoeroticism. Equiano's social consumption always happens in the context of intimate, homoerotic relations, a fact suggesting that intimacy and connection rather than abjection and disconnection might have best facilitated the slave social consumption. For the most part, our scholarly responses to African accusations of cannibalism have failed to penetrate the surface. This is the case even as the accusations against Europeans proliferate, arising from local patterns of thought and belief about cannibalism. Generally speaking, Africans taken by force from their home communities feared Europeans, whom they frequently thought of as ministers of destruction, magicians, and flesh eaters. Otoba Kugwano, a West African captured by English slave traders and taken to England, recalled the first time he saw whites. "We came to a town where I saw several white people, which made me afraid that they would eat me, according to our notion as children in the inland parts of the country." Joseph Wright, of the Egba people of Nigeria, fell into a deep depression when his kinsmen sold him as a slave to the Portuguese. At the root of his depression was the common belief that the Portuguese were going to eat us when we got to their country. Even worse, by way of reputation than the Portuguese, were the English, whom some African groups understood to be an even more vicious species of cannibal. After their capture by the Portuguese, Wright and his kinsmen come the next day upon an English man of war. He fully believes the Portuguese when they describe the English as the real species of cannibal. They, the Portuguese, told us that these were the people which would eat us if we suffered them to prize us. Scholars of the transatlantic slave trade and the black experience have tended either to metaphorize or dismiss such examples as superstitious thought or unfounded indigenous terrors. Scholarship on the life of Otabenga, a pygmy man brought to the United States in the late 19th century and displayed as an attraction in a zoo, exhibits these tendencies. Benga is described by his biographer as believing that white eyes, white men, are cannibals, a fear ascribed mostly to superstition Benga and the equally savage Apache chieftain Geronimo shared. Benga, who is portrayed as prone to childish pranks and witchcraft, and his pygmy-based cannibal beliefs are thought to have no critical bearing upon the structures of U.S. imperialism and exotic consumerism. Mia Bay situates African beliefs that European were cannibals in a historical context that ultimately reinforces Western conceptions of reality and overlooks the social logic and human science behind African cannibal beliefs. She attributes such beliefs to traditional African tribal animosities that place the imputation of cannibalism on distrusted foreign peoples, and to the fact that Africans taken by the Europeans in the context of slavery were usually never seen again. Bay concludes that African misapprehensions about white cannibalism were not real. Rather, she finds them to be based on a distorted historical viewpoint, a viewpoint easily corrected with facts. In white cannibals, black martyrs fear depression and religious faith as causes of suicide among new slaves, William D. Pearson draws conclusions similar to those asserted by Bay. He also attributes African misapprehension of white cannibalism to several culturally limiting and determined factors. These include the fact that kin and kinsmen who were taken in the slave trade were never heard from again, coastal Africans' mistrust of foreign peoples, and the widespread belief among differing African groups that the more suspect tribes, such as the Igbo, Coromantes, Angolians, Ibibiros, were cannibals. Such logic, while meant to be corrective, has ultimately reinforced the idea of the African as superstitious and lacking a civilized perspective on the world and humankind. Furthermore, such thinking presumes a historical trajectory in which beliefs and practices related to cannibalism are pre-civilization, with civilization being characteristically European and associated with Western advancement. We are not in the habit of thinking about slavery and consumption as coterminous realities. It seems such an unreal occurrence to those who know very little of the global history of slavery and human consumption. Carl O. Williams, extrapolating from observations of ancient Icelandic slavery, describes the slave master as the ultimate human parasite, one whose fundamental relationship to the slave is that of a consumer to a food source or commodity. He writes, "This class of the lowly is the source from which the master class draws its livelihood and leisure. Thraldom, slavery, is a degree of cannibalism. It is a system of man feeding upon man. The master is a human parasite who, by the right of might, has secured his fellow man in the bonds of thraldom in order to feed upon them and use them for the satisfaction of his appetites." According to Orlando Patterson, sexual desire and codes of masculine honor strongly inform this culture of human consumption described by Williams. What the slave mainly fed was the master's sense of honor in his sexual appetite. After methodically butchering and cooking a male slave over a rolling open fire, one Kentucky slave master reported to his wife that he had never enjoyed himself so well at a ball as he had enjoyed himself that evening. Such incidents proliferated throughout the slave trading diaspora, especially in the Caribbean and the Americas, where carving, cooking, and eating of flesh served as punishments and conditioning rituals. Typically, masters derived feelings of pleasure and social empowerment from rituals of torture and consumption. Patterson, concurring with Williams and drawing upon analysis of slavery among primitive Germanic peoples, observed also that slaves were socially consumed, and that this process of consumption was endemic to all other slave-holding societies, both before and after European global expansion. Importantly, both Williams and Patterson foreground the erotic and, more specifically, the homoerotic desires of masters that shape and inform master-slave relations. Masters received a sexual high or erotic charge from the consumptive acts. Power and sex intertwined with the slave's body, and sex serving not only the purpose of pleasure and erotic fulfillment, but also reinforcing the master's authority, supremacy, and dominance. Romancing the cannibal. Equiano's The Interesting Narrative of the Life of Oluwadu Equiano, or Gustavo Vassa, is today regarded as an exemplary specimen of African civilization and cultural production. Equiano is not the silent and culturally determined Agostino, who speaks but is not heard. Instead, Equiano, an African-born, formerly enslaved man, managed to achieve literacy and pen his narrative, which is not only a vindication of his Igbo people, but a model of literature in the genre of the travel, slave, and exploratory narrative. While little substantive scholarship has been written on the topic, Equiano's text remains one of our most thorough and elucidative explorations of the European acting as a type of cannibal in the transatlantic context. In his travel narrative, Equiano describes a culture of cannibalism based in practices of cutting, harvesting, and cooking flesh. In keeping with Patterson's assertion, a homoerotic sexual appetite facilitates the African social consumption in Equiano's narrative.
Homoerotic desire serves as a mean of tasting, ingesting, and cultivating an institutionalized appetite for African flesh. Furthermore, in Equiano's narrative, the institutions of Christian fraternity, chivalric homoerotic love, transatlantic mercantilism, and literacy all serve as a means through which European and American white males cultivate high cultural tastes for African males and perpetuate metaphoric and erotic rituals of consumption. Scholars of Equiano's life and work have categorized and studied the interesting narrative as a slave narrative, a travel narrative, and an autobiography. Though it fits into all of these categories, I approach the text primarily as a slave narrative. When Equiano penned his narrative, British abolitionist efforts were well underway. The interview between Agostino and representatives of the British Select Committee reflected the British government's determination to throw its full legislative powers behind the ending of the African slave trade. In the prefatory material to the narrative, Equiano includes a letter that he wrote to the British Parliament. The letter begins, "Permit me with the greatest deference and respect to lay at your feet the following genuine narrative, the chief design of which is to excite in your august assemblies a sense of compassion for the miseries which the slave trade has entailed on my unfortunate countrymen." Equiano wrote with the intention of locating himself and his narrative within this national abolitionist conversation. Equiano's abolitionist sentiments and finely attuned awareness of English feelings of cultural superiority distinguish his text from narrative written by his peers. It is the perfect text for initiating a discussion of black male consumption in a transatlantic context, as it is the prototype of the slave narrative and prefigures representations of white cannibalism in the slave narratives published by black American men in the 19th century. Henry Louis Gates Jr. has described Equiano's narrative as the silent second text of the narrative of the life of Frederick Douglass. Following a marketing strategy established by Equiano, Douglass distributed his slave narrative on both sides of the Atlantic and received acclaim in U.S. and British abolitionist circles. Equiano's narrative, like none written before or after, provides an early snapshot of black experience and identity as transatlantic. It is the story of a West African child sold into slavery, bartered among white masters, and raised aboard schooners that traversed the Atlantic carrying slaves and cargo from England to the Caribbean, and then to the United States. Equiano begins his narrative as an isolated and traumatized child whose overwhelming response to slave captors is fear and terror. He fears he will be eaten. He fears the whites are cannibals. Equiano first raises his concern that the whites are cannibals after British slavers purchase him and take him aboard the slave ship African Snow. Secretly, the African youth questions his bonded kinsmen about the whites. "I asked them if we were not to be eaten by those white men with horrible looks, red faces, and long hair." The first section of his narrative documents his constant preoccupation with cannibalistic Europeans. His initial observations are only confirmed by visions of boilers and African bodies chained together, presumably waiting to be fed to the boilers. "When I looked round the ship too and saw a large furnace or copper boiling and a multitude of black people of every description chained together, every one of their countenances expressing dejection and sorrow, I no longer doubted of my fate, and quite overpowered with horror and anguish, I felt motionless on the deck and fainted." Even after the crew of the slaver and his own kinsmen confirm for him that he is not to be eaten, Equiano's fears persist. When the crew captures a shark and hoists it aboard the slaver, he reports, "This gladdened my poor heart exceedingly, as I thought it would serve the people to eat instead of their eating me." Playing upon his fears, the ship captain, also his slave master, would often threaten to eat Equiano and his best friend Dick. He said he would kill Dick, as he always called him, first and afterwards me. Equiano, later in the narrative, reflects back on his childish ignorance and views of Europeans and corrects himself. That fear, however, which was the effect of my ignorance, wore away as I began to know them. I could now speak English tolerably well. I no longer looked upon them as spirits, but as men superior to us Africans, and therefore I had the stronger desire to resemble them. Equiano strives to be, and does ultimately become, an Anglo-African. I soon grew a stranger to terror of every kind, and was, in that respect, at least almost an Englishman.
In this pivotal section of the narrative, Equiano seems to resolve the issue of European cannibalism by attributing such perception to his indigenous naivete. Scholars have, for the most part, followed his prompt, assuming that the issue of human consumption has no bearing on those portions of the narrative that follow Chapter 4. The remaining chapters of the narrative, Chapters 5 through 12, depict his further cultural training and his sometimes harrowing, sometimes pleasant initiation into the ways of English civilization. I want to suggest, though, that the subject of cannibalism in the narrative is more complex than this. Later in the narrative, Equiano describes a culture of human cannibalism wherein whites perform as human butchers in order to satiate their appetites for African flesh, terror, and sometimes sex. In the context of such occurrences, white men relate to Equiano as a delectable object who is not so much literally consumed as tasted, erotically desired, and cultivated as an object of male erotic needs and social stature. Patterson's idea of the master as a parasite who forces the slave to feed the master's sense of honor and his sexual appetite dictates Equiano's relationship to white men, who subject him to both personal and institutional parasitism. Equiano's first encounter white cannibalism through romantic love and companionship with a young white male shipmate. Richard Baker appears in Equiano's narrative and life as a type of young chivalric prince. Working off the stereotype of the African race as effeminate compared to the more masculine, martial nature of the Anglophone European, Equiano reconfigures the codes of chivalry by casting himself as a type of male princess, and Richard as the saving prince. The Negro was, after all, thought of as the lady of the races, a more effeminate species compared to the Anglo-Saxon. As a specimen of the effeminate species, Equiano fits perfectly into the arms and racial mythology of his white suitor. Richard Baker is an American slave master, a young lad with an excellent education, and a most amiable temper. It seems, in Equiano's eyes, unimportant that Baker owned slaves back in the United States. Although this dear youth had many slaves of his own, yet he and I have gone through many sufferings together on shipboard. Young Richard bonds quickly with Equiano in what the author refers to as a friendship. Within the plantation culture from which Richard comes, friendships between young whites and black males were always framed by the master-slave dynamic. The author makes no attempt to qualify his friendship. He does not refer to the young black slave boys who were used as nursemaids and made to play the roles of comrade, friend, and servile slave on plantations. Within the context of such plantation friendships, young white boys developed and honed the skills of conqueror. Susan Snow, a former slave, recalls fondly that her young master would work in the fields with the slaves. "My young master used to work in the field with us. He'd boss the niggas. They'd call him Bud, but us all called him Babe. Honey, I showed and loved that boy." Snow romanticizes this white youth who practices the exercise of authority over black adults. Adults who have raised him and labor for everything he will one day own. Equiano's friendship with and ensuing romantic love for Baker is more complicated than Snow's maternal love. Richard civilizes the young African. Through Richard, Equiano learns that the talking book, the Bible, does not actually talk. Rather, one learns to read this book and decipher the messages encoded therein. Richard helps Equiano move beyond his savage thinking and upbringing. At night, Richard and Equiano find comfort, warmth, and safety in each other's arms. And we have many nights laying in each other's bosoms when we were in great distress. This theme of the saving, intimate embrace of a white youth is not unique to Equiano's narrative. The same year his narrative reached print, a French author, Joseph Lavallée, published the novel Le Nègre comme il le peut le blanc. Lavallée's novel, an international phenomenon, appeared almost immediately in English translation. In the novel's dramatic opening scenes, the main character, Itanoko, escapes from an African prince who desires to use and uses him as a sexual object. Itanoko is swimming madly towards an offshore slave ship. The ship's officer pulls him out of the water, immediately remarking upon his beauty and physique. "This is the finest black I have ever seen," he says. Itanoko is nude, and it is noted earlier in the translated English version of the text that he lacks pudicity, modesty concerning his genitalia. Musing aloud about his ironic feelings towards Itanoko, the ship hand imagines the captain as the luckiest man for having the choice of this African man to share his bed. "Zounds," cries the officer on watch, with an energetic oath, "that's the finest black I ever clapped my eyes on. How lucky is the captain? Why fortune hunts him even in bed?" Itanoko, like Equiano, speaks in the master's tongue, French, and is instructed in Christian ways. Several men initiate him into these rites, but the most significant is Ferdinand, the ship's captain's son. Itanoko feels an uninhibited romantic love for this youth, declaring that "nothing gave me so much pleasure as the sight of Ferdinand." Tall and finely formed, he possessed an ingenuous countenance, which ever attaches the heart in the first instance. I could not resist it. While Equiano labored to produce a work of nonfiction, he was not immune to the fictional conventions of sentimentalism and the European's romanticization of the African. Lavallée caters to these homoerotic hungers for the African's body, and the widespread popularity and translation of his novel in France, England, and the Americas attest to this social reality. The similarities between Equiano's work of real-life experience and Lavallée's fictional work are striking. These similarities reveal a culture of white sexual hunger for black flesh that was so widespread that a Frenchman and an Anglicized African writing in different genres and from different geographic locales seized upon the same resonant themes and images. Beds, bedsides, and bedclothes are significant motifs that run throughout Equiano's slave narrative. At the bedside is where Equiano stages his most intimate religious conversion moments. The first moment involves himself and Richard lying in bed in an embrace and then praying together at bedside. Later in the narrative, Equiano will replicate the situation with an adult white Englishman and with a semi-clad Native American youth taken from the Caribbean. Richard teaches Equiano, an orphan African child, to look to a symbolic white deity father for solace and comfort. The Christian principles of sacrifice and selflessness reinforce in Equiano a servile identification with the desires and hungers of white men. As kind and loving as Richard is, he ultimately conditions Equiano to better play the role of slave. Months earlier, Equiano had lain below another ship deck in a scene of death and stink so thick that he could not breathe. Thinking back to that time, Equiano recalls that he had scarcely room to turn himself. The heat sweltered and cooked. Babies carried on board or born on the ship, it is not clear which, tumbled into tubs of feces and urine and almost suffocated. Everyone was dying, and many literally perished, falling victims to the improvident avarice of their purchasers. The thick filth and layers of body in the scene contrast sharply with the clean, open air in which Equiano lies in the young white slave master's arms. Equiano feels himself chosen by his young white companion, drawing upon the mythology of Christ and the myth of white innocence to convey to his readers Richard's kindness and altruism. Equiano describes Richard as kind, agreeable, and faithful. Richard is safe and speaks kind Christian words, while the evil, worldly ship captain constantly threatens to eat Equiano. The captain relays his carnivorous messages through Richard, fondly referred to as Dick by Equiano. He used to tell him jocularly that he would kill and eat me. Sometimes he would say to me, the black people were no good to eat, and would ask me if we did not eat people in my country. I said no. Then he said he would kill Dick, as we always called him, first, and afterward me. Taste and good taste. The captain, of course, never eats Equiano, but his persistent references to Equiano's delectability are instructive. A better understanding of how taste itself is cultivated will help us understand how the ship captain's desire to eat Equiano belied a real, acquired taste for the enslaved African person. In Consuming Passions, The Anthropology of Eating, Peter Farb and George Armelago note that tastes do not just emerge as full-blown realities. Rather, they emerge from a complex of historical and cultural forces brought to bear upon a culinary object. Cultural, historical, and ecological events have interacted, they write, to cause frogs, for example, to be esteemed as a delicacy in southern China, but to be regarded with revulsion in northern China. They go on to describe how the acquired taste for a substance has to do with availability, the ease of culinary preparation, domestication that results in accessibility, nutritional value, cost, and the ability of said substance to reproduce itself efficiently, among other factors. At this early stage in Equiano's chattel career, we can already place him neatly within this abbreviated list of things that constitute cultivated taste. He is isolated from his natal land, community, and language, rendering him entirely available. White males accomplish his domestication or recasting in a familiar cultural register through the conventions of chivalry, invocations of Negro effeminacy, and the implanting of Christian values. Culinary utensils, Christian ideology, English traditions of romance and affection, and ideas of Africa and Africans as heathens enable the cultivation and carving up of Equiano in the Eurocentric mind. And it goes without saying that the economic benefits of slavery translated readily into the currency of white male identity and acquired appetite that Richard, a child of the U.S. slaveocracy, and the captain, an English slave owner and trader, enjoy. Although Equiano, the narrator, emphasizes his enlightened, objective, and pristine relationships with white men throughout the narrative, this economy of taste reveals how thoroughly an acquired appreciation of the slave permeates and feeds into European ideologies and institutions used to condition the young slave. If Equiano is anything, he is nutritious fare, reifying and fortifying the social stature of Richard and the captain. Jean Athelm, Brilliant Saravine, expound on the exponential potentials of taste, notes that the number of tastes is infinite, since every soluble body has a special flavor which does not wholly resemble any other. Tastes are modified, moreover, by their combinations with one, two, or a dozen others, so that it is impossible to draw up a correct chart, listing them from the most attractive to the most repellent. In Equiano's narrative, these multiple implications of taste inform the triangulated relationship among the young white male lover, the African beloved, and the hardened cannibal-like ship captain. This triangulation of two white males erotically tied to Equiano recurs throughout the narrative. Traditionally, in English culture and literature, a white woman is the binding object of affection. Eve Kosofsky Sedgwick explains this dynamic. Within the male-centered novelistic tradition of European high culture, the triangles are most often those in which two males are rivals for a female. Despite the metaphoric centrality of the female, the homoerotic attraction and rivalry between the men is often more powerful and determining. In any erotic rivalry, the bond that links the two rivals is as intense and potent as the bond that links either of the rivals to the beloved. The bonds of rivalry and love, differently as they are experienced, are equally powerful and in many senses equivalent. In this case, it is the delectable young Negro who serves as a different type of effeminate prize. Equiano's body and person mediate a subtle dynamic of rivalry and homoerotic chivalry played out between the captain and Dick. By asserting his power to eat and consume, the captain also asserts his phallic might and right of ownership. Dick, by virtue of his aristocratic class status, American civil identity, and interest in Equiano's humanity, represents something of an economic and erotic threat to the captain. And at the same time, these refined qualities in Dick, added to his youth, make him erotically appealing to the captain. Triangulation serves to intensify desire. The special heart bond between Dick and Equiano excites the captain, who openly admits to the desire to ingest both of them. The picture of the white colonizers making Negro soup that I cite in the introduction clarifies the dynamic I am describing among the two whites and the black youth. In that picture, a commanding military officer, his attendant, and porter gather around a skewered Bakongo man. The missionary and explorer are implied, as military occupation would not be possible without the initial paving of the missionary and explorer. In Equiano's situation, his master and the captain of the ship is a naval officer. Dick is a devout Christian who has a bit of the missionary's zeal. Both Dick and the ship's captain, Michael Henry Pascal, are emissaries of their respective states. Christianity, romantic friendship, British militarization, and U.S. slaveocracy are all employed in the making of Equiano into a new world object of gastronomical delight.
Equiano portrays Richard as innocent, disconnected from the larger cannibalizing circumstances that have brought the two boys together. Richard has to stand apart if he is to serve as the young African's kind interpreter, his reliable mediator into white ways and white culture. Equiano's genteel, kindly white readership had to identify with Richard, to see themselves in his kindness and altruism toward this slave, if they were to ultimately accept Equiano's transition from savage to noble gentleman. However, the captain, in his crude fashion, implicates Dick in the larger culture of African cannibalization. He anticipates the 19th century American concern over Christian cannibalism and other forms of institutionalized consumption of slaves. Richard is Christ-like, and for Equiano to experience Christian saving, he will have to sacrifice himself, give himself over to his young savior. A part of this sacrifice involves accepting himself as heathen, denying his color and African features, and through Richard and Christianity, learning to identify with and worship white masculinity. Much later in his narrative, Equiano will mark a turning point of spiritual growth and intellectual development with an increased admiration for whites' beauty and spirit. "I no longer looked upon them as spirits," he writes, "but as men superior to us, and therefore I had the stronger desire to resemble them, to imbibe their spirit, and imitate their manners. I therefore embraced every occasion of improvement." Equiano's relationship with Richard prepares him to encounter, later in life, Daniel Queen, an attendant aboard the ship Etna. At this point in the narrative, the narrator has passed through the hands of several masters. When he is approximately 13 years old, he is taken into service aboard the Etna by his master, who is the ship's captain. Queen is a bachelor and a bit of a dandy, with a fine eye for dress and male couture. He is also devoted to biblical lore. Equiano's relationship with Queen centers on issues of taste and good taste. Queen instills in Equiano a more refined taste for English gentlemanly presentation and comportment. Through continued biblical studies, Equiano satiates his appetite for white spirit, which he will later apply to a Native American youth whom he attempts to colonize. Equiano and Queen, an African youth and an older white man, fall quickly into something of a Christian romantic relationship. On many occasions they, like Equiano and Richard, stay up the whole night together, talking about European high culture and manners and the practice of those same customs in Equiano's homeland. Equiano makes small, loving sacrifices on Queen's behalf. "Many things I have denied myself that he might have them, and when I used to play at marbles or any other game and won a halfpence or got any little money, I used to buy him a little sugar or tobacco, as far as my stock of money would go." Thinking of Queen in a sweet manner, Equiano would purchase for him sweet things. Queen, in turn, would respond with the desire to remain forever close and bonded to the African youth. "He used to say that he and I never should part, and that when our ship was paid off, and I was free as himself or any other man on board, he would instruct me in his business." Rendering his relation to Queen in the language of Christian romantic love, Equiano described how his heart burned, how Queen treated him with the greatest kindness and the feelings of tenderness he imbibed from Queen. In spite of his feelings of romantic and religious freedom, Equiano's relationship to Queen does not set him free. Instead, his ties to and learning under this white shipmate reinforce a culture of social consumption. Equiano's relationship with Queen feeds the older man's sense of nobility and moral sanctity. His homoerotic desire toward the African youth reinforces in Queen the feeling of paternity, a paternity that many on the ship acknowledge by sometimes calling the youth after the elder man's name or referring to Equiano as the Black Christian. Equiano and his white father slash master relate through a paradigm of human parasitism. The African socialization, his training in English morality, religious values, and spiritual devotion temper the savage within and make him into something culturally palatable, desirable, and beautiful to Queen. Converting Equiano ennobles Queen. And while Queen is not Equiano's documented master, he does play the role of paternal figure and enjoys an incestuous relationship with the youth that parallels the Heavenly Father-sacrifice-son dynamic. Queen is a surrogate for the white father god. Equiano, the child and ignorant, innocent, in turn plays the role of the sacrificial son. In this context, the Christian doctrines of eating flesh and drinking blood, suffering, and dismemberment take on a clandestine meaning that contradicts the narrative of universal love and soul-saving that Equiano foregrounds. The subtext of Queen's laborious instruction in Victorian manners, customs, and religious values is the idea that Equiano comes from a heathen land and is, fundamentally, a heathen subject. It is not, after all, Equiano who instructs Queen in his indigenous customs and social values. queen, with missionary conviction and commitment, works to convert Equiano through the promised love of a deific white male figure. Equiano converts his Christian love into an imbibing and ingesting of whiteness to the extent that he makes sacrifices for this white man who would rather instruct him in Christian morality than literally free Equiano from the manacles of slavery. As hard as Equiano, the narrator, tries to divorce the kindness of Queen from the cruelty of his captain master, he cannot. At the end of this particular voyage, infuriated at Equiano's relationship to Queen, the master violently sets himself upon Equiano. "He forced me into the barge," the narrator recalls, "saying I was going to leave him, but he would take care I should not. I was so struck with the unexpectedness of this proceeding that for some time I could not make a reply. Only I made an offer to go for my books and chest of clothes, but he swore I should not move out of his sight, and if I did, he would cut my throat." Equiano's training in religiosity and English etiquette make him even more of an acquiescing, ignorant slave, for he cannot see that the whole time he has rested under the wing and influence of Queen, the captain has watched and taken note. All the while, feelings of anger and betrayal have brewed in the captain. He is not only angry at the thought of losing his valuable commodity, he also feels betrayed by the slave's interest in and affection for Queen. Still fuming after the physical attack, the captain decides that as further punishment for his betrayal, he will sell his young slave to a new master when they reach their destination, Portsmouth. All this time, Equiano has thought that his acculturation into English ways would ensure his freedom, his being manumitted from slavery. After the captain sells the African youth and formally introduces him to his new master, Captain James Dorian of the Charming Sally, Equiano tries to explain to his new master why his sale was illegal. "But I have served him, Pascal, many years, and he has taken all my wages and prize money, for I only got 1 sixpence during the war. Besides this, I have been baptized, and by the laws of the land, no man has a right to sell me." He invokes the statute of chattel law on his behalf, noting that he heard lawyers explain to his master that it was illegal for him to hold an African man who had undergone baptism. It gradually dawns on Equiano that his acculturation, instead of preparing him to be free of slavery, has prepared him for a final initiation into a new slavery, more intimately tied to the appetites of white men and rituals and practices of flesh-taking and consumption. Consumption under the new slavery. The Charming Sally frequently transports slaves from Africa to the Caribbean. As a result, Equiano spends a significant amount of time in Barbados, Montserrat, and other parts of the Caribbean observing overseers whom he describes as human butchers practicing their cruel trade. One of the first narrated examples of this cruelty is a Negro man staked to the ground and cut most shockingly. His crime involved being connected with a white woman who was a common prostitute. While staked to the ground, the overseer, bit by bit, cut off pieces of each of his ears, prolonging what was already a horrific and unbearable punishment. It was common practice in the Caribbean to not only cut off the ears of slaves, but to also broil them and make the slaves eat the broiled pieces as a punishment. Anglican missionary John Wesley documented this phenomenon in his Thoughts Upon Slavery. He writes, "After they are whipped till they are raw all over, some put pepper and salt upon them, some drop melted wax upon their skin, others cut off their ears, and constrain them to broil and eat them. In this way, the slave was made an accomplice to his or her own social consumption." Such acts of auto-cannibalism, self-consumption, reinforce for the slave the interrelations among punishment. Slavery as the slow, incremental death to body and soul, and the general culture of slave seasoning as a process meant to prepare the slave for all manner of consumption. In the 1700s, John Atkins, a surgeon in the British Royal Navy, recorded an insurrection that occurred aboard a slave ship. The captain and crew quelled the insurrection and, as punishment, made the captured African persons eat human body parts before murdering them. Three others, abettors, but not actors, nor of strength for it, he sentenced to cruel deaths, making them first to eat the hearts and liver of one of them killed. The correlation in this example between execution and death by consumption is noteworthy. Rosalind Shaw observes that among conflicting cultural groups in the colonial era, such acts of auto-cannibalism reinforce the militarized and legislative authority of a dominant group. Not only do we consume you, the captain of the British Royal Navy conveys, but we also make you consume each other. These incidents of auto-cannibalism punctuated a more subtle and pervasive reality of starvation and self-consumption. Within this new Caribbean context of slavery, masters frequently employ tactics of starvation, which range from incremental loss of food to more blatant and debilitating forms of hunger. Early on, Equiano makes note of his masters feeding a group of slaves well instead of starving them, as their own master frequently does. My master often gave the owners of these slaves 2.5 of these pieces per day, because he thought their owners did not feed them well enough according to the work they did. Starvation is so endemic to slave culture that when Equiano's master rents the Igbo man out on jobs, he has to pay a white man to accompany him. The sole responsibility of this white man, whom he pays from 6 to 10 pistrians a day, is to make sure that those who rent Equiano feed him each day. Once, Equiano recalls, for a few days, I was let out to fit a vessel and had no victuals allowed me by either party. Equiano was made to literally starve for several days. Slaves treated thusly had less of a will to disobey and resist. Starvation ensured control and set the stage for the master to enact even more heinous forms of social consumption. Though not necessarily made to consume his or her own broiled flesh, the emaciated slave still embodied a condition of daily and incremental self-consumption. In commercial terms, the slave's emaciated body translated into the blood and flesh currencies of social stature, increased wealth, and spiritual domination for the master. Quite literally, the master held within his hands the powers of life and death.
Context of White Supremacy, Gus T. Renegade. First portion of the audiobook, The Delectable Negro, all done. We had slight tech issues, like a myriad of minor tech issues, but I think we were able to take care of everything. Regardless, the audio archive will be pristine. For folks who dialed in, shouldn't have been a problem at all. Just for the folks that are streaming, hopefully we'll be able to take care of any issues there as well. And there were other minor tech issues that caused us to start a few minutes late, but be that as it may. Again, we'll restate Dr. Welsing. She said, be not discouraged. You have to expect these sort of obstacles, and you just do your best to move forward. In that vein, the number to dial, 641-715-3640. The code, 564-943-pound. Press *6 if you would like to participate. The number again, 641-715-3640. The code is 564-943-pound. Press *6 if you would like to participate. If you want to join the dialogue but you don't want to use your phone, you can use the free VOPE line. It works anywhere in the world. It's linked at Black Talk Radio Network. If you need the address, it is tiny, T-I-N-Y.cc /1 race, and that is the number 1. The address again is tinytiny.cc/1race, and that is the number 1. When you enter that address, click the link on the left side of the page. Says free vote line. When you click that, it will open a small window on your screen. The top line, it is a drop-down menu. Select the number that I just gave out, which, again, is 641-715-3640. The next line, it will ask for the code. That code, again, is 564-943. Final line, it will ask for a name. You can use your real name, nickname. You can press random keys, whatever you're comfortable with. Once you get all that information entered, click the green button at the bottom. We will be able to add you to the line. It's the same procedure if you would like to participate. You'll see the dial pad on your screen. Press *61 and we'll see your hand and get you on the line. Please do not wait till the last minute. If you think you have comments you would like to share, observations, go ahead, dial in, get your hand up, and we'll make sure we get to everybody. If you could try to take about 5 minutes with your commentary, that would be grand. So everyone who has a hand up, line should be open. Feel free to share your observations.
Can I be heard?
Yes, can I be heard?
Heard right. Both of you. We'll go with 5771.
All right, thank you. Greetings, Gus. Greetings to all the callers and listeners. Lots of metaphors, trying to understand them and catch up with them. I remember back in the turn of the century, there was somebody that was trying to debunk Inquiano's narrative, talking about he wasn't old enough to remember most of his, you know, time or whatever. And I'm wondering if it was because of this part of his, homoeroticism with the white slave masters that he encountered, and also the cannibalism that he also experienced with the white people. The connotation of Richard and Dick, I've seen that in corporate America a lot. You know, working in corporate America, that white people who was named Richard preferred to be called Dick, you know, in regards to a more sexual overtone. So, you know, white people are very, you know, they got the nerve to say that us, you know, non-white black people are over sexual, but, you know, they're the ones naming themselves Dick. And as far as European culture, you know, they're, you know, talking about Africans, you know, African males being the women of their race, you know, European culture. You know, during that time, they were wearing wigs and putting on, you know, powder on their face. And, you know, you got an old white man named Queen, and, you know, and they got the nerve to say that African men were effeminized, but they're constantly, you know, doing feminine things. And also, one last thing, one of the things that said, at the time, Equiano has had thought that his acculturation to English ways would ensure him of his freedom, him being manumitted from slavery. Well, you know, it still happens today where we think that, you know, if we, you know, set ourselves and, you know, into a white society, that we will be accepted by white people. And, you know, just like it with Equiano's experience, you know, he was no more accepted than any other non-human that, you know, that tries to act human. So that even, you know, happens today. So it doesn't matter how much education we have, doesn't matter how much money we make, doesn't matter where we live at, you know, we're still considered niggers to white people. That's all I have for now. I'll mute my line.
Right on. The other caller who spoke up simultaneously, did you have commentary?
Yes, I was basically going to say something similar to that, what Equiano was going through, just trying to convert. I have a family member that pretty much always tells me, like, go to church, you know, do this, that, and the third, and maybe white people won't look at us in a certain way or do things to us. And that's what it kind of reminds me of. And also, I recently was told about a group called the Bohemian Grove. I have an older gentleman that I talk to once in a while, and he's a Mason. He told me that there's a group called the Bohemian Grove that is like quote-unquote prestige white men who carry on these rituals where they're molesting black people or even lynching them. But I never asked him, was it like, were they doing it like with people in current day, or they had like a mannequin or something like that? But he did tell me that. And another thing is, every time we go through a book like this, I always wonder, like, white people, they say that they don't like us so much. They really hate us. But then it's like they need to be around us. So it's a weird thing that I'm really trying to understand. It's like they hate us. We're the worst people on the planet. But then they always want to be around us. They want to have sex with us. They want to eat us. It's like the weirdest thing that's kind of unexplainable. And that's pretty much it. I'll mute my mind.
Great observation. Calls to mind Mr. Fuller. He started with audio from him today. I think he has on the back of the original code book, geez, just things to think about, where he says most black people don't hate black people because we are not white. Most white people hate black people because they are not black. And I might have, you know, mixed up a word or two, but that's the general gist of it, kind of getting at what you said, but just something to think on. Other folks that we have not heard from, if you have a hand up, you should be with us. Feel free.
May I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
One of the main observations I made with all the homoerotic and homosexual things they were saying in the text, and it was all Equianos, if I'm pronouncing his name right. When I was younger, I'm 42 years old now, but when I was younger, I was always told by the older black people in my family that it was white people that were more prone to homosexuality. Now, they didn't have, you know, I'm older, so they wouldn't sit you down and give you the background about white people being more prone to homosexuality, but this book does, and I'm glad. That's one of the... that just made me think about that, how when I was younger, you know, we would get, they would talk to us and they would tell us about white people, not really going into detail, but that was one of the things that they would tell us, that white people were more prone to be homosexual or gay. And at the end of the reading, I can see we're getting into auto-cannibalism. I kind of read a little bit of ahead, and just the act of, I mean, cutting someone up and then making, you know, some other people like them. Like, they wanted the other black people to eat some black people that they cooked up. And so this book should help us realize what we are dealing with today in the 2017. I say this, that these are the same people that were doing all this. I mean, I know these people are dead, but these are these people's offspring. And that's the that's all I wanted to say for right now. This book is great. I'll mute my line.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Greetings to you, Gus, and to the other callers and listeners. For the previous caller that was discussing the, I think it's Orange Grove, I'm just slipping my mind right now, I'm a victim, but it's actually happening now. That's part of what you're hearing about when you hear them talk about Pizzagate. It's something that they used to do, and it's something that they're doing right now. Also, that information has come out that Bill Clinton was involved in a lot of this too. Donald Trump is connected to it via Jeffrey Epstein. So there's a lot of that, and it's still happening right now. And it's a global phenomenon. It's not just in America. It's the political elite in Australia is coming out about them, in Britain. So it's definitely something that's still happening as we speak. To get to the text, just like the first caller said, the vast majority of everything white people have ever said is just one big projection when it comes to what they say about black people. Every single thing that they've ever said about us is exactly their entire lifestyle. And their culture, their religion, everything about them is literally everything that they've ever said about black people. There was an interesting, because I read this book before, so I have so many notes and so many highlights all over the text, so I'm trying to just touch on things that I think really stand out that are very important. On page 31, he writes, many historical texts on the subject of slavery describe the importance of the process of seasoning for breaking men and women and making them into docile slaves. Elaborating on the culinary connotations of the word season, to heighten or improve the flavor of food by adding condiments, spices, herbs, or the like. I link the physical, brutal culture of seasoning to the parallel development of erotic appetites, tastes, and aesthetic longings for the black male. This broader understanding of seasoning is important as it helps to explain how institutional processes such as Christian indoctrination, religion, male fraternal love and bonding, sex, and the acquisition of literacy and facilitated, and literacy would be education, and the social consumption of the Negro, and the creation of a high cultural premium on African flesh. So they're breaking down how all of these different aspects, all of the 10 areas of people activity, all function to propagate and promote and uplift the system of white supremacy, and all of it is geared towards the consumption of black people. Also, they're calling this behavior high culture. Throughout the text, there's a couple of sections where he actually said European high culture, and there's no such thing as European high culture. Everything about European culture is deviant and destructive, especially to the lives of black people. There was a section on page 34, where he writes, importantly, both Williams and Patterson foreground the erotic and more specifically homoerotic desires of masters that shaped and informed the master-slave relations. Masters received a sexual high or erotic charge from consumptive acts, power and sex intertwined with the slave's body and sex, serving not only the purposes of pleasure and erotic fulfillment, but also reinforcing the master's authority and supremacy and dominance. And these things remind me of 909. One time a while ago, he called in and he talked about a book called The Quarrel, The Argument Between Poetry and Philosophy, where you can really study about how white people globally, and this has to do with Greece, but globally, wherever they went and conquered people, one of the things they did was wholesale rape the men to effeminize them and to basically remove any semblance of fighting for their own liberation. This is also something you can read about the Vikings as well. They've gone around the world, and wherever they went, they would rape the men mercilessly in order to do the same thing. So this is white psychopathology just in the most heightened way possible and the most brutal form. There's so much more I could talk about, but I want to give other people a chance to speak, and maybe I'll get a chance to bring up some other things later. But this text is just incredible. And lastly, just to before we get to the end of the book itself, there is a section where he talks about the history of so-called homosexual behavior on the African continent, and he doesn't, in my opinion, put it in proper context, because Africans never propagated or practiced homosexuality until we came into contact with Europeans and Arabs, and the time frames he's discussing is the exact time frame where Europeans and Arabs were conquering the continent. So I just wanted to put that out there. Thank you, and I'll mute my line.
Other folks that we have not heard from, if you dialed in with a hand up, lines should be open.
Yes, Brad, be heard.
Yes, sir.
Greetings, Gus. Greetings to the other callers and listeners. Demi Ford here. The late Vincent Woodard was, I think we've already gathered a gay black male, and a lot of the authors and people that he uses to make his points are anti-sexual or classified as gay. And personally, I consider saying gender-loving people's behavior incorrect. When it comes to the bedroom, and of course, you already stated that the American Psychiatric Association 30 years ago had homosexuality listed as mental disorder. But we know that they've been wrong before for whatever that means. But I think that because Mr. Woodard's sexual preference, because of the sexual preference, he was uniquely qualified to investigate a subject like human consumption and homoeroticism within the U.S. in the slave culture, because it never been done before, and seemed like it was being intentionally omitted. As far as the cannibalism goes, Europeans has viewed other people, you know, we say non-whites, I guess, as cannibals, and in fact, it was practiced in their own culture. It's noted in a book by Louise Noble, Medicinal Cannibalism in Early Modern English Literature and Culture, where remedies contain human bones, fat, and human blood were concocted, dating back to 1600s, recipes, turning blood into marmalade. Leonardo da Vinci had said that we preserve our life with death of others in a dead, incinerate life remains, which, when it's reunited with the stomachs of the living, regains sensitivity and intelligent life. So you can draw your own conclusion on that. But we mentioned the ship, the Essence, and where the four black, shipmates were eaten, cannibalized. We know about the Donner Party. They murdered two Native Americans, Salvador and Luis, butchered them and ate them. The 1972 Andes flight crash, where they ate their dead in order to survive. And it's been movies made. The one that Hannibal Lecter described as intellectual, brilliant, cultured, sophisticated, and refined, with refined taste in art, music, and cuisine, had been. One of his famous quotes was that he ate the liver of a census taker with guava beans, and supposedly he was traumatized as a kid and after watching his sister being cannibalized. So they're familiar with cannibalism, and it's throughout their history. Back to the book, that seems like when they first started talking about the interview with Augustino, they only mentioned the interrogator as the British interrogator, but then they named Augustino. And a lot of times in literature, when we see this happening, there's seem to be concealing the identity of, you know, the whites. The British interrogator could not understand what had put the idea into the slaves' head that they were to be eaten. Are they eaten in their own country, said the British interrogator, as ignorant and suspicious of Africa as the new slaves were of the white world? And I doubt that very seriously. We can't underestimate the people classified as white like they are ignorant. And another page, on page 31, it said, in my contention that somewhere between European denial and African accusations of a new species of civilized white cannibal was born. This white cannibal was unique to the Middle Passage and transatlantic slavery. In addition, literal acts of eating, carving, and cooking flesh, Europeans and American whites developed a culture of cannibalism, wherein daily acts of violence, religious conversion, slave seizing and breaking, and sexual brutality all fed into the master's appetite for African flesh and souls. So what I like to say, just when you think that you've become acquainted with every terrorist act or every act of inhumanity known to man that has been perpetrated against non-white people, especially black people, then we come to the fact that we've been cannibalized too. We were eaten. Our ancestors were literally eaten during the period of antebellum, where we had been reduced to enslaved individuals. Just like to make one last point about Equiano, which typically it symbolizes why sexual intercourse with people who classify themselves as white is incorrect because of the confusion that it had caused for Equiano. He could not distinguish between the kindness of so-called what he thought was kindness from the people who were raping him and terrorizing him. He could not distinguish between the racism and the affection, or so-called what he had replaced sexual terrorism with affection and love, and basically causing traumatic confusion in his life. And I'll mute my line and give somebody else a chance. Thanks for taking the call, Gus.
For sure, for sure. Anybody that we missed, anybody who dialed in with a hand up that we have not heard? Yes, ma'am.
Greetings, beautiful people. This is Emmy. Two things. The first, I don't think that it, or a couple things. I don't think that it can be stated enough that Equiano was a child. I was astounded at a certain point when he said at the age of 13, then something else happened. And I was like, all that had happened happened from 0 to 13, or from whenever he was sold into slavery to 13. And so it's not even just homosexual behavior, homosexualizing a person, an African person, but it is pedophilic homosexualizing, which the trauma from a psychological perspective, I really just don't even have words. I'm sorry. I would try to articulate it, but I can't. And so in listening to it, I thought it was absolutely fascinating how his first so-called baptizing into Christianity, or his first real spiritual moment, was being wrapped in a white male's arms and being told about God, this white man, God, and all of that, like, conditioning is the word that I kept hearing over and over and over again. We are victims of racism, white supremacy, because we've been so conditioned for so long. And that's one story that we have a record of. But there have to be innumerable, countless experiences that are similar. I even remember, and I wish I could cite the source, but I can't at the moment, that the Christian missionaries, and I was very happy about that word Christian being used so many times, but that the Christian missionaries, when going into the continent of Africa, would be giving the little kids sugar cubes. And, you know, after, you know, saying that Jesus loves you or convert over here, then giving them sugar cubes. And see, that's conditioning. Even though it may not look like it, but over time that is conditioning, especially because these are children, how sugar reacts with the brain, how sugar reacts with the body. Sugar actually can, you can become dependent upon sugar. I mean, it's very similar to other molecules that have addictive tendencies or whatever. So anyway, so when the sugar was brought up, and then I thought it was absolutely fascinating how Equiano was giving his money, his precious energy, his time. He would even let this white person win. I mean, to the same extent that we've been conditioned in a way that is unhealthy, these white people have been conditioned to continue to regard us in such a way. And I think it's absolutely fascinating that it was standard knowledge amongst non-white people that white people are cannibals, period. Like, to the point that an entire ship of potentially enslaved African people revolted, not because of the slavery necessarily, but because they didn't want to be eaten by white people. I mean, wow. And the thing about the whole Christian thing, why I'm enjoyed, or not enjoyed, but I thought it was constructive to hear the word several times, is because a lot of other times before they try to say that white people conceptualized a concept of whiteness, that Christian was code for white, non-Christian or anybody else was code for non-white. And so in another book, The Destruction of the European Jew, they keep, and see, for me, when I look at a Jew, I saw white people. So I didn't really understand. But in reading, I began to understand a little bit more. So this whole process, so like what that means in the mind is you would think, well, by becoming Christian, I become closer to white, which means that I won't get hurt so much. But even conversion does nothing because it's not about the religion. It had nothing to do with the religion. It has everything to do with whether or not a person is white or non-white, skin color. And so I thought, you know, I don't need... It would just be great to have psychological analysis of what it must have been like for Equiano when he said, I did everything right. Like, what are you talking about? I'm Christian. I've been baptized. And all because such and such got jealous because of some affection I have for someone. I mean, and even that, like, this is a young child who has been passed from one old white male to another white male to another white male to another white male. You know what I'm saying? And constantly, like, wow, like I don't even have words because I think we can see the effects now. And that's why I'm grateful that we're reading the book. That's why black men are walking around with purses. The rates of homosexuality in the community are so high. We're on the genocide slide. I mean, all of it. Because for one record of Equiano, there's has to be millions upon millions of similar stories and situations. And thank you. I'm good.
The great Cleo Monago is rolling over in his grave. Anybody that we have missed, anybody who has a hand up that we have not heard from at all? Yes, got everybody. Outstanding. Quick comments I want to get in. Number one, I messaged Dr. Tommy Curry, who recommended that we read this book to begin with. Shout out to Dr. Curry. And just asked if he could hook us up with some supplementary material, biographical information on Mr. Woodard, how he died, more information about his life and times, the editors who put this book together. I think it's very important that we keep in mind this book was posthumously published. So, I mean, anytime we talk about books that are published while the black person is still alive, man, racists can really go to work when they get to publish some material after the author has already died. So that should be kept in mind. And I'm asking Dr. Curry if he has any details on that, if the editors have done any interviews, just whatever he can hook us up with that he thinks would be beneficial. So when he gets his collection together, I will share. Also, just the child rape aspect of all of this that Emmy just commented on and others as well reminded me of another book I had thought of for the book club, Dark Places of the Earth, The Voyage of the Slave Ship Antelope. And this is written by Jonathan Bryant. He's a white male suspected racist, but it deals with this one enslaving ship, and he emphasizes specifically that this is really about child abduction, because the average age of most of these quote-unquote enslaved black people, I think, was like 10. And it's the exact same thing that we've heard here
But it just, it's that one book is just following this one slave ship and the trial. Francis Scott Keyes gets involved because I think there's a big trial about these stolen black people. Admitted racist Francis Scott Key, who wrote the national anthem. If folks want to do additional reading, it's Dark Places of the Earth, The Voyage of the Slave Ship Antelope. Other notes that I took specifically from this week's text. I had never thought, it reminded me of Gwen Ifill, the book, I think it was David Axelrod, when he said, he was talking about the Obama campaign, and he said that, you know, one of the things that you can do to be deceptive is that you use words to describe a certain idea or concept, but you do so in a way that it conveys different ideas to different people. Everybody doesn't arrive at the same conclusion, and that's deliberately. And just the use of the term seasoning, and him taking the time to really deconstruct, unpack the usage of that term. I'd heard people, many even people that are on the broadcast right now, describe the what they call seasoning process, where black people are niggerized. We're going to groom you so that you will be, we'll have an easier time enslaving you. And this happening in the Caribbean, and then the black people, after they have been seasoned, they're taken wherever they are. I had not heard anyone examine that term and say, well, wow, wait a minute, you seasoned food. Why is this term being applied to this process of torturing black people? And I just, that paragraph, I think Roz already read it. It might even deserve repeating, but I just thought that that was exceptional scholarship and something that I had never heard before at all, just when you start to get a more accurate understanding, and really a more accurate understanding of whites and what it means to be white, and not the nonsense renditions of enslavement that we generally get in school. I thought it was really important as well, and kind of got the male caller who shared earlier where he said this paradox where racists are constantly, oh, stay away from the Negros, and, you know, we're going to have segregation, and don't touch us, and stay away from my daughter, and don't look at us, we don't want to go to school with you. But then, you know, they can't stay away from us. They're copying and stealing from us, and they've got to be in bed with us, and literally eating, devouring black people. What to make of that contradiction? I think he has a line. The line where he says, he's talking about Alano Equiano, where he says, Equiano's social consumption always happens in the context of intimate homoerotic relations, a fact suggesting that intimacy and connection, rather than objection and disconnection, might have best facilitated the slave's social consumption. I think that continues to be the case today. In fact, this is the logic I present when people talk about white people killing all black people, where I say, I don't think that's their goal. They could do that now. They could have done that for a long period of time. What they want is to continue devouring, abusing black people. That is their pleasure, to have us around to stomp on and chomp on. Moving forward. Let's see. I thought this was a really important paragraph where it says, Equiano later in the narrative reflects back on his childish ignorance and views of Europeans and corrects himself, that fear that they were cannibals, however, which was the effect of my ignorance, wore away as I began to know them. I could now speak English tolerably well. I no longer looked upon them as spirits, but as men superior to us Africans. I think that is very, very common to this day, like 2017. Common, where, and I feel like I've heard black people where they said, I was racist, and I meant what I said. I was a black person, and I was racist. I hated all white people, but I was so ignorant then. I was just bitter, and, you know, I've grown so much, and I've become, I mean, I hear that right now from people, which in my view just shows how devastatingly effective this system is, where you see a lot of the exact same behavior patterns, where we will have an accurate understanding of what it means to be white, but we lose it. We lose it frequently, and it sometimes it can just take one white person to be nice to us or whatever. And I also think the circumstance, I thought Emmy's observations about this happening to a child, Alano Equiano, I thought that was extremely important to keep in mind. So we're not talking about someone who has fully developed cognitive abilities and processing and trying to make sense of all this, who's been stolen and raped and terrorized in an unimaginable manner, and on top of that is still a child and doesn't even have fully developed mental abilities. But I think for many, many black people, we end up in these situations of total terrorism where our very existence is dependent on a white person. Like, whether we get a glass of water is dependent upon a white person. Whether we go to the bathroom is dependent on a white person. Like, we end up in those types of situations all the time. And I mean, you talk about psychological warfare. Dr. Welsing, we talked about Stockholm Syndrome, but you end up in these type of environments. You're out stuck on a floating prison, basically, on this slave ship. I mean, my goodness, any individual classified as white that even halfway looks like they're not trying to kill you, rape you, whatever, that they might be nice and give you a crust of bread and, you know, a drop of water, man, that is going to be my homie forever. And I think just the dynamic of racism, white supremacy, it creates those type of parasitic relationships where the white person, they have everything. They have the power. We are in a weak position and a lot of times dependent on them to make sure that, you know, we have some, you know, some sense of quote unquote safety. It's right for us to be exploited sexually or otherwise. And I think it's important as well where he points out the homoeroticism, where even if sexual activity is not happening, there is still sexual arousal and exploitation, sexual exploitation happening, even if it is not the literal act of intercourse. Other things that stood out. Let's see. Equiano describes a culture of human cannibalism where whites perform as human butchers in order to satiate their appetites for African flesh, terror, and sometimes sex. I thought that was even important because the sex aspect was last. An appetite for African flesh, whatever we're doing, if that means beating African flesh, because you'll see sometimes in bondage acts, right, like it's not even the sexual act, you just want to beat on a person and see their skin be marked up or see if you can make them bleed or what have you, doing that to enslaved black people. We've already heard about that, just lashing a black person or just having them be in fear. Even I think there have been so many comments where Equiano, where he's talking about being on these slave ships and people just saying, well, I'm going to eat you, I'm going to kill you, just saying that and having that black person be afraid. We've had so many people talk in the workplace environment where white people just saying things just to get you upset or just to have you irritated and nervous. That right there, I think my man in Macedonia, he was talking about narcissism, Sam Bachman, he would call that, I think, narcissistic supply, when racists, they get to just go around and terrorize and abuse black people and just say things and just see us jump, as they say, narcissistic racist supply. Some of the other things that stood out, really important, where he says, working off the stereotype of the African race as effeminate compared to the more masculine, martial nature of the Anglophone European, Equiano reconfigures the code of chivalry by casting himself as a type of male princess and Richard as the saving prince. The Negro was, after all, thought of as the lady of the races, a more effeminate species compared to the Anglo-Saxon. As a specimen of the effeminate species, Equiano fits perfectly into the arms and racial mythology of his white suitor. I see a lot of this play out today. I would even say this might fit uncomfortably well for professional athletics. It seems that so many athletes, black athletes, male and female, for them to, you know, reach their potential and be the great athlete that they could be, they need a white savior to come in and take over. And whether it's a black male, black female, it has to be some white person who's there to guide them. That's how you end up with the blind side in these type of events. It seems very similar, and just the whole emasculation of black males, that seems to be just an ongoing process, a core component of racism, white supremacy. I know Dr. Welsing has talked about that a lot. And again, go right back to the beginning of this program with Neely Fuller Jr. And he said it's not Adolf Hitler, it's Jeffrey Dahmer, about the effeminizing black males. I think that goes right to the core of Dr. Welsing's theory of white genetic annihilation as well. Would be great to, man, could have heard her thoughts on this. What a, should have read this earlier. Should have read this earlier. Let's see if I get in one more thing, then we'll have time. Folks have anything else that they would like to get in before we conclude? I thought it was really important. Yeah, this will be the, when he's talking about these young race soldiers that Alado Equiano is having contact with, racist man, racist woman, racist child. Even these young white boys seem to be very knowledgeable about racism, white supremacy, and what is expected of them as a white boy, soon to be white man. He says, Woodard says, within the context of such plantation friendships, and I love that he put friendships in quotes, young white boys developed and honed the skills of conqueror. And he describes in that same context how Equiano and young black people in this same situation, these plantation friendships, they are learning how to be niggers, better, well-behaved niggers, while the whites are learning, this is what domination looks like. This is how I function as a racist. I can pause there. Folks have anything else they want to get in before we get to the text? I mean, yeah, next portion of the text.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, there was a couple of things in the book I wanted to touch on. But first, I was going to say, in my opinion, just based on what Mr. Demery Ford had said in a piece to you as well, I think the author is also the perfect person to have written a book of this type, because I think he was his experience makes him uniquely qualified, simply because as a person who was practicing homosexuality, he himself was actually being consumed, like he describes in the book. After reading this book, I came to look at all antisexual relationships, whether they're interracial or so-called same-race couples, are acts of consumption, especially since there is no act of procreation. There's nothing no life is going to be propagated from this. Whereas with heterosexual behavior, one is giving of oneself. Both the woman and the female and the male are giving of themselves to create new life. So, to me, antisexual behavior in all of its forms is a form of selfish consumption. It's something that we have now been taught by white people. After reading this book, I never look at white people the same. I look at them with the same. When you hear Olowoode Equiano and the author describe how black people just thought of them as cannibals, like, I look at white people with that same, like, I just don't trust them. I think they're capable of anything. When I see white people walking their dogs, I'm thinking they're raping those dogs, because that's something that they do. Also, I think that all of these things that he's describing in the text are byproducts of being inbred. Just like Dr. Wilson said, they're an inbred race, and there's a lot of mental illnesses that come with that. And I think these are functional psychotic mental illnesses that white people have that we're watching them play out. And to get to the text on page 44, he wrote, "And while Queen is not Equiano's documented master, he does play the role of paternal figure and enjoys an incestuous relationship with the youth that parallels the heavenly father sacrifice son dynamic. Queen is a surrogate for the white father god, Equiano the child and ignorant innocent, in turn plays the role of the sacrificial son. In this context, Christian doctrines of eating flesh and drinking blood, suffering and dismemberment take on a clandestine meaning that contradicts the narrative of universal love and soul saving that Equiano foregrounds. To me, when I think of the Christian religion, all of these things are what stands out to me. And also, it's showing you that through teaching him this filthy behavior in a Christian context, they're also teaching him how to lie, because they say that he foregrounds the text with universal love and soul saving, when in reality it's a bunch of rape and racism that he's going through. A little bit further down in the text, he says, Equiano converts this Christian love into an imbibing and ingesting of whiteness, to the extent that he makes sacrifices for this white man who would rather instruct him in Christian morality than literally free Equiano from the manacles of slavery. That's the reverse of Jeffrey Dahmer. He's trying to imbibe whiteness to become white. And like they said, the system of white supremacy, which they're calling Christian morality, is what is really more important than literally freeing this man that you're raping from slavery. And lastly, on the following page, he writes, after the captain sells the African youth and formally introduces him to his new master, Captain James Dorian of the Charming Sally, Equiano tries to explain to his new master why his sale was illegal. But I have served him, Pascal, many years, and he has taken all of my wages and prize money for I only got 1/6 during the war, and besides this, I have been baptized, and by the laws of the land, no man has a right to sell me. He invoked the statute of chattel law on his behalf, noting that he heard lawyers explain this to his master, that it was illegal for him to hold an African man who had undergone baptism. And in this part of the text, when he talks about the fact that he served him for many years, he's looking at slavery in an African context, where in Africa, when you were enslaved, you would be enslaved for maybe 5 to 7 years, and after that, you were a free person who could rise through the ranks of society. And all the difference was, in Africa, slaves had rights. If you were mistreated by your master, you can complain to the king, and they would remove you from that household. Whereas in
pause
Europe,
right quick just to make sure. Sorry about that,
sure,
Ralph. I just want to make sure anybody else didn't have anything quick they wanted to get in before we get to the second audio segment. Everybody satisfied? Nothing else folks needed to make sure they get in before we get to the second audio segment?
I did want to mention one last thing.
Yes, sir.
Okay. The time when they, in the book where this master was renting out Aguano and actually sent a white man with him, paying him 6 to 10 pennies a day to make sure that he ate, right? And then he still literally starved for several days. And it just shows, you know, that's right after they had described the seasoning part. So there's a, you know, emphasis on these people classified it themselves as white, is getting enjoyment out of just actually torturing. And I'll mute my line on that.
Right on. Anybody else, anything quick they need to get in before we get to the second audio segment?
Yeah, I was looking in the index, and Christianity is used a lot in this book. I just wanted to get that in real quick.
Right on. Anything else? Everybody satisfied? I was bummed when the portion of the book where they were talking, the kind of section where we ended, where they were talking about auto-cannibalism, where they were forcing black people to consume their own flesh or the flesh of other enslaved black people that were being tortured and what have you. That has popped up numerous times in different books and authors that we've had on the program over the years, and my own research. I remember there was a lynching where during the lynching they castrated the black male and then made the black male eat his own genitals and tell them how good they were. Like, this was written out extensively, like somebody witnessed this and they wrote that out, and I was trying to find it so I could read like the exact text, like this is where, you know, this is what's happened, this is where I read this. But that sort of thing, I've read it numerous times, where this just seems to be a core aspect of racism, white supremacy, and these sort of just sadistic pathological acts that are just main traditions, white culture. With that, I assume...
Can I get one thing in quickly?
20 seconds.
20 seconds, for sure. The part that Mr. Demrefort just brought up about the white man having to pay another white man to watch him reminds me of the fact that white people cannot even trust their own people, and it's just what they did to our ancestors on the plantation. They had to make sure they got every minute of work out of you, and that's what they were doing in that situation as well, by protecting their goods, quote-unquote, making sure he ate. Thank you.
For sure. We will make sure we have time for after the second audio. We will get started. We're picking up. We're still in chapter one. This is Vincent Woodard's The Delectable Negro, Context of White Supremacy, audio segment number 2.
In another example from Equiano's Caribbean Observances, the taking or harvesting of flesh is a regular occurrence. A particular nameless master has a reputation for cruel punishments. He had not a slave, but one had been cut, and had pieces fairly taken out of the flesh. the idea of a human butcher seems to apply expressly to this individual. Equiano does not go into detail about what is done with the flesh carved out of individuals that he leaves to the imagination. In the context of such occurrences, white men experience a sense of deific power. Furthermore, Equiano makes a point of emphasizing that the master takes pleasure in this and other torturous activities, to which he has clearly given much thought. It is easy to apprehend how such events conditioned and made humans into slaves. However, less ascertainable is the fount of meanings embodied in the master's pleasure-taking. The choice of the word pleasure rather than satisfaction or purpose, for example, cues the reader to the fact that this is an interchange of power, erotic energy, and soul. Following such brutal treatment, Equiano observed that many masters would make slaves go on their knees and thank their owners and pray, or rather say, God bless them. Plantation masters frequently cited Old Testament biblical references to devotees blindly serving their master. But this scenario, which draws upon biblical tenets, goes beyond simplified notions of morality, the typical roles of master and slave, and the master-slave relation. This scene brings into stark relief a moral problematic based on the spiritual and esoteric implications of a white man gathering identity unto himself from the wholly available and serviceable lives of Africanist others. For this type of religious rite, we do not have a fully developed linguistic framework, nor do our typical understandings of the science of human interaction sufficiently account for the esoteric implications of the plantation master's pleasure-taking. The state of pleasure that Equiano describes connotes horror, objection, and human vampirism. In this context of social death and energetic exchange, pleasure operates as one, an organic unit, a life-sustaining energy readily bartered and exchanged during slavery, and two, a process of internalizing and imbibing spirit and soul force. In Rituals of Blood, Consequences of Slavery in Two American Centuries, Orlando Patterson approaches this dynamic from the perspective of the enslaved person. Intersecting Christian theology with the consumption and sacrifice of slaves, he notes that the slave and ex-slave had always been the major symbol of sin in Christian theology. Because Christianity, from its beginnings, had identified the state of sin as one of enslavement to the flesh, it stood to reason that the Afro-American slave or ex-slave was the perfect symbol of sin. Patterson analyzes Jim Crow lynching rituals as ancient sacrificial rites, cannibalistic feats, and attempts to feed a deity of terror and appetite usually referred to as God. Though my interest, like Patterson's, centers on the ritual behavior of whites and the construction of deity, what I am more interested in are the specifics and moral implications of whites creating themselves as deific agents. It was one thing for whites to draw upon Christian theology as a means of justifying their consumptive rituals and appetites, and an altogether different matter for them to use Christian theology and social ritual as a means of feeding and sustaining self and social stature. Africans throughout the continent frequently equated European Christianity with human consumption. In the Gambia, it was thought that Christians ate human meat and that all the slaves that they bought were carried away to be eaten. Shaw records that in the Gambia at the turn of the 16th century, rumors of the European consumption of slaves identified the trade with Christians as a form of predation. Debunking the idea of the Gambians as ignorant, uninformed Africans, Shaw notes that this was hardly a reaction of isolated Africans to sudden commercial contact with the outside world. Rather, through observance of and sustained contact with Europeans, the Gambians had come to regard the slave trade as a trade that fed the Christian appetite for the consumption of humans. That was viewed as problematic. In other words, the Gambians ascertained in Christian ritual and deity
a process of soul harvesting and soul hunger that coincided with the bodies Europeans had also come to claim and transport. If we accept the conclusion of Europeans as soul and body harvesters, then we have to wonder how Europeans might have used, commodified, and ingested the very African souls that they consistently claimed did not exist. In Sierra Leone, an African typically regarded the white man as purchasing him either to offer him as a sacrifice to his god or to devour him as food. Again, Shaw notes that persons from Sierra Leone and other regions viewed the slave trade as European ritual process that integrated the transport of African bodies across the Atlantic into a further set of transactions with the European's god. The people of Niger even applied these notions of deity, deification, and consumptive practices to the slave ship itself, describing it as some object of worship of the white man. These African-based perspectives bring into clearer focus how European practices of soul harvesting and human consumption coincide with the more obvious economic motivations of the trade. These observances bring us back to that seemingly obvious question. What exactly did Europeans want with African persons? What deity and processes of self-deification did the African soul and body feed? We cannot readily access these types of considerations through the Europeans' notion of their Christian practice. European Christianity advocates, at least overtly, the consumption of the divine, but not the consumption of another human being. The African-based perspectives of European Christian consumption inverts this logic, honing in on European religiosity, religious ritual, deity, and self-making as processes based in appetite and human consumption. When the African spoke of Christians as human consumers or of Christianity as a religion based in human consumption, what they were observing and articulating were the Europeans' hungers, appetites, willfulness, glut, greed, and titillation, all operating through an institutionalized context of spirit and soul edification. Africans, we might say, saw through the rhetoric of European spirituality to the real spiritual motivations informing the Europeans' relationship to the slave trade. Europeans would insist that they had come to offer something to the African soul, to nurture, tame, and sustain this wild entity. However, what many African groups quickly ascertained, without the benefit of European literacy and theological learning, was that in fact the European had come to harvest and spiritually ingest them. In presenting us with masters who buried their slaves alive and commanded their slaves to pray to and deify their persons, Equiano provides a glimpse into a Christian world that belied the Europeans' pristine notions of religiosity and saving of the savage, African other. Equiano, like so many of his peers and ex-slaves who would later pen their own narratives, attempted to describe and convey the reality of institutionalized consumption. He attempted to convey the extent to which European self-delusion and cultivated appetite for the African had thoroughly transformed institutions such as Christianity, the law, literacy, and philosophy. In the section on the new type of slavery, Equiano makes reference to a Mr. Drummond, a Caribbean slave owner who owned over 41,000 slaves. Drummond, with little forethought, would cut off a man's leg for running away. Equiano asks this Drummond, if the man had died in the operation, how he, as a Christian, could answer for the horrid act before God. Drummond replied that answering was a thing of another world. What he thought and did were policy. Even in the context of heinous abuse, Drummond invokes the lofty theological tenets of Christianity, a heavenly realm disconnected from the material world, the notion of delayed moral accountability, and a sense of deity removed from the immediate day-to-day actions of men's lives. In bringing up the topic of Christianity, Equiano encourages his reader to ponder the interconnections between Christian theological practice and Christian masters such as this, whom he frequently describes as human butchers, flesh takers, and death dealers. In deflecting the conversation onto the afterlife and a deity located elsewhere, Drummond evades the issue of his own self-deification and the larger question of exactly what type of deity his gluttonous flesh-harvesting actions fed. Equiano, for his part, resists at the same time that he reifies the common slave's institutionalized consumption. It is impossible to divorce Equiano, whose narrative authority and spiritual validation derive from the deification of white males, from the plantation consumption scenes he relates. What saves Equiano from the fate of the common slave is his acknowledged difference. One master, he relates, said he did not mean to treat me as a common slave. I told him I knew something of seamanship and could shave and dress hair pretty well, and I could refine wines, which I had learned shipboard, where I had often done it. By this point in the narrative, after his introduction to the new, more brutal form of slavery, Equiano understands well that only his usefulness and closer social proximity to affluent whites saves him from the consumptive fate of the common slave. Probably a combination of terror, rhetorical maneuvering, and genuine aesthetic appreciation of Europeans causes him to say, "I no longer looked upon them as spirits, but as men superior to us, and therefore I had the stronger desire to resemble them, to imbibe their spirit, and imitate their manners." This seemingly casual statement, strategically placed in the text, signals Equiano's transition from heathen childish African to civilized Anglo-African adult. In order to gain greater authorial credence, Equiano professes to no longer believe that whites are spirits from a different realm of existence, spirits who are cannibalistic agents of a cannibalistic slave trade. Driving this point home, Equiano even depicts himself as an enlightened consumer who has learned from the European to imbibe their spirit and imitate their manners. How to lay claim to humanistic discourse and at the same time acknowledge cannibalism as a personal and social reality? This is the conundrum Equiano faces. In my later discussions of 19th century figures who follow Equiano, this challenge of claiming a discourse of humanity that demonizes and makes heathens of black witnesses of white cannibalism recurs and presents an epistemic challenge. To stand before the high European or American court of civilization, before the panoptic presence of the interrogator, claiming enlightenment alongside white acts of human parasitism and cannibalism was incongruous. In the end, Equiano's desire to survive by imbibing and imitating white ways results in his becoming parasitic and implicated in the projects of white male deification and global occupation. The result of this cultivation is fully realized 13 years later. Before embarking on a privately funded venture to the West Indies in 1775, Equiano encounters in London four Miskito Indians who had been taken from their homeland and brought to Jamaica by some English traders for some selfish ends. The youths are described as chiefs in their own country. The sponsor of the trip to Jamaica, Dr. Irving, is returning them to their West Indian homeland. In the meantime, though, we are pointed to the fact that while all of the youths are royalty, noble savages in their own right, there is one among them who was the Mosquito King's son, a youth of about 18 years of age. This youth, more than any of the others, draws Equiano's attention. Performing the role of surrogate Negro mother, Equiano feels it his divine duty to introduce this youth to his well-beloved master, Jesus Christ. Taking the heathen youth under his wing, as he was taken by Richard Baker and Daniel Queen, Equiano instructs the boy in the English alphabet. They study religion and pray fervently together. I make such progress with this youth, especially in religion, that when I used to go to bed at different hours of the night,
If he was in his bed, he would get up on purpose to go to prayer with me. Equiano makes a point of noting that the youth would kneel and pray without any other clothes but his shirt, and that before he would eat his meals with any of the other men in the cabin, he would first come to me to pray, as he called. An incestuous intimacy developed between the youth and his African instructor. The image of the youth semi-clothed underscores his vulnerability, an erotic availability to Equiano and to Equiano's well-beloved master, Jesus Christ. His nakedness implies an infantile, trusting state. He presents himself to Jesus Christ as an innocent, powerless child would present himself to an all-powerful, nurturing father. In this case, though, the father is a slave master, an instrument of English imperialism and martial might. Equiano, as a feminine subject, is a natural counterpart to the father. He nurtures the youth in his stead. This undercurrent of violence and captivity in the context of Christian conversion is poignantly conveyed in an interchange between Equiano and the youth. Fascinated with Equiano's copy of John Fox's Martyrology, the youth asks him numerous questions about the papal cruelties he saw depicted there. Such poignant questions are punctuated by the fact that the native youths have been taken through trickery or lies, it is not clear which, from their native land. By this time in history, the English and other European groups had thoroughly occupied and colonized the Caribbean islands, and long before they had imported Africans to work on cane, tobacco, and rice plantations, they had decimated Native American populations. These groups had been systematically hunted and murdered in a style and heinous manner that often paralleled papal cruelties. In 1378, the Pope sent inquisitors into the Waldensian valleys of northern Italy. Inquisitor Borelli had 150 citizens, including women and children, burned alive in Grenoble. In the same region, in 1400, citizens were chased from their homes in the dead of night by inquisitors on Christmas Eve. The following morning, strewn across the snow-packed hills, more than 50 children were found frozen to death in their mother's arms. Equiano explains away such necessary cruelties in order to make such progress with this youth, especially in religion. When the young Equiano had been baptized in 1759 in a Westminster church, the presiding clergyman had given him a book titled A Guide to the Indians. European missionaries used this text, written by the bishop of the Diocese of Sodor of Man, to assimilate Native Americans into the Christian faith and to justify genocidal actions taken toward Native groups that did not conform and assimilate. This interchange between Equiano and the Miskito youth marks a pivotal moment for Equiano. At this crucial juncture, the roles are completely reversed. Where Equiano was once a self-described superstitious infantile African, he paints himself at this point in the narrative as an enlightened, gentlemanly Anglo-African. He describes the youth as a poor heathen and his tribesmen as emissaries of Satan. Equiano steps earnestly into the role of social pariah. He is not a fully endowed white British man. However, he is the European's chosen love, helpmate, and co-creator in the kingdom of European civilization. He serves as a middleman within this particular economy of Christian cannibalism. The Miskito youth ultimately rejects Equiano's advances. With the support of his clansmen, who tease him and inquire if the black missionary has converted him to Christianity, the youth sees through Equiano, through the hypocrisy and irony of the moment. How comes it, inquires the youth, that all the white men on board who can read and write and observe the sun and know all things, yet swear, lie, and get drunk, only excepting yourself? His question insufficiently answered, the youth stays to himself for the duration of his journey back to his homeland, and Equiano never sees him or speaks of him again in the narrative following his return. The slave trade as soul trade.
Within the closed circuit of Equiano's Anglo-African logic, it is difficult to get at how it might have been possible for the European to consume the African soul or, for that matter, to get at a systematized understanding of the esoteric purposes to which the energy of the consumed body and soul might have been applied. 19th century American whites, whom I discuss at length in the next chapter, also attempted to apprehend the implications of Christian cannibalism, but found such a notion a philosophical and ontological impossibility. Equiano comes from a world in which man-eaters and witchcraft are components of a complex science of human behavior and moral interaction. Just as Enlightenment discourses policed and ensured moral behavior in a civilized populace, African witchcraft belief often maintained the moral and individual center of a society. In actuality, witches or cannibals were not literal flesh eaters. They were individuals who drew off the human life force, causing their victims to weaken physically, become ill, and sometimes die. Anthropologist Wyatt McGaffey recorded this millennium-old belief in Central Africa through his field research in the Congo in the 1960s. He learned that the Congolese had long associated the transatlantic slave trade with soul theft and witchcraft. In this aspect, therefore, witchcraft is similar, as a European would say, to slave trading. It is not clear, however, that Bakongo make any distinction between the two. Repeated contemporary references to 19th century trade, the slaves in particular, show it is regarded as a trade in souls. Some of the techniques used are identical. Informants recall, and written sources confirm, that slave catchers used to leave food so that hapless travelers, finding it and picking it up, might be seized for debt and sold. Modern witches are supposed to leave money in the road for the same purposes. According to Bakongo cosmology, the soul is luminous, like a shining star. The soul is the seat of good health, and when it is undisturbed, the body flourishes. The soul should be round, like the sun, but witchcraft attacks may cause it to crumble at the edges, rendering the body vulnerable. Witches may suck or draw off all or part of the soul, depriving all or part of the body of its inner essence, so that in a short time it will be seen to sicken or die. Europeans who first encountered Africans questioned the nature and existence of an African soul. This was partially racial prejudice, but also a reflection of the very different ways Europeans and Africans define the nature and origins of the soul. Within European Enlightenment discourses, the soul was a lofty thing. A soul distinguished upright man from the animals who crawled on all fours. The soul was immaterial, connected to religion, and best cultivated within the higher realms of civilization. The iridescence of the soul was connected to white skin, and the origins of the soul rooted in the sky. God descended from the heavens to breathe soul into Adam and Eve. According to Descartes, the difference between the human and animal soul was that the human soul granted mankind higher order thinking and moral consciousness. In this philosophical and religious context, it would have been nearly impossible for the most well-intentioned European to see in African a soul categorically similar to their own. The denial of the African soul would be the subject of philosophical and theological debate for centuries. However, a large portion of this debate went to justify a simple political end: profit and gain through the enslavement of humans. Europeans among themselves needed ideological justification for their heinous and vile mistreatment of Africans. When Africans such as Equiano, Kugwano, and Phyllis Wheatley, among others, first argued their humanity to whites, they began always with the issue of the soul. Equiano's entire narrative is testimony and proof of the existence of a civilized soul. His initial desire to learn the Bible, his series of religious conversions, his romantic Christian friendships, and the eventual missionary post he held in West Africa are all offered as evidence of a soul equal in moral aptitude and reasoning capabilities to that of Europeans. Yet the irony of Equiano's argument for his human soul was that he made it to imperialist institutions in an Anglophone society that had a fundamentally immoral relationship to Africans and Africa. None said it better than the English gentleman Charles Dickens, when he referred to the African savage as something highly desirable to be civilized off the face of the earth. Africans were brought to Europe and locked behind museum cages and bars. Europeans displayed their genitalia and scientists studied their harvested body parts. Even when the English accepted Africans into society, it was under a mandate of racial cleansing. In the context of the Bakongo science of the soul, such demonstrations of European gluttony and knowledge-seeking belonged in the category of behaviors attributed to witches and cannibals. Still today, in Sierra Leone, the conviction that slaves carried away in the Atlantic trade were eaten by Europeans persists. This conviction had many strands of belief, which involved 1. The European sacrificing the African to his god. 2. The traded African serving as a literal food source for European slavers. And 3. The slave being used as a trade commodity between cannibals or witches. Not just European foreigners were accused. In Sierra Leone in the 18th and 19th centuries, it was common to find a powerful chief who had stepped out of the bounds of moral human existence, accused of being a cannibal. In such contexts, coastal African associated cannibalism with unhealthy social functioning. The cannibal was a person who fundamentally threatened the well-being of the community. Such persons were thought to literally and symbolically consume land, the ability to prosper and grow from the land, the people, and the very chiefdom itself, in the case of chiefs accused of cannibal behavior. Numerous African groups guarded against the emotional states of extreme anger, greed, envy, jealousy, and hatred because such feelings were thought to have a culminative, unseen power that acted negatively upon an individual and community. Usually, a ceremonially sanctioned person who had the power to guard against cannibals in a community received training in a science of dream interpretation, wherein cannibalism that occurred in dream or spirit was an indicator of imbalance in an individual and community. Europeans who first encountered Africans and later European colonizers stationed in Western and Central Africa habitually interpreted the African sciences of human cannibalism literally, going out to look for cannibals and for particular objects or slipping off skins that could be found only in spirit or in the dreamtime realm of emotional causation, a living experience domain that parallels what we think of today as the unconscious. What differing African persons and groups universally recognized in Europeans whom they accused of being cannibals was a state of greed, gluttony, appetite, jealousy, and anger that had reached dangerous, unchecked psychic and spiritual proportions. To dismiss African observances that Europeans were cannibals as myth and superstition is to dismiss this very valuable and poignant insight into human capacity and immoral potential implicit in most indigenous African cosmologies and esoteric sciences of human consumption. It was not at all inconceivable, according to such a worldview, that slave masters could create themselves into deities and that slave ships that gorged themselves until full could operate as part of a larger network of institutions wired to a destructive human need for consumption. This African notion of consumption under slavery as a fundamentally moral problematic overlapped with a similar concern voiced in 19th century U.S. religious and political spheres. In Chapter 2, I analyzed the 19th century U.S. cannibalism debate, which focused on slavery as a consumptive institution
that was pervading and corroding American religious, legal, philosophical, and artistic institutions. Ironically, at the same time that Africans struggled to translate their understandings of European cannibalism, so too were white and black Americans beginning to craft a collective language and ideology of human consumption under slavery.
Context of White Supremacy. That will wrap up this week's book study session. If you would like to dial in and share your thoughts on the second audio segment or anything that we heard from the text this week, feel free. The number is 641-715-3640. The code is 564-943-pound. Press star 6 if you would like to participate. We should have a good half hour before the conclusion of the book. So if you have commentary, go ahead and get your hand up. Please do not wait until the last minute. All the folks who dialed in who have a hand up, your line should be open. Feel free. Just double checking. The caller at 7722. Did we hear from you? Have we heard from you today, or is this your first time sharing?
This is my first time sharing.
Okay, you should go first.
Yes, thank you. Greetings to the caller and the host. Yes, I've had a real challenge reading this book. It's been very difficult for me to comprehend some of the concepts that are being laid out by Mr. Woodard. But one thing that stuck out to me was the portion dealing with Christianity and the concept of being sinful, and that being equated with the slave and the state that the slave was in. I found it extremely telling, specifically this chapter, how the effect that Christianity, being the religion of white supremacy, and white supremacy, of course, infiltrating any quote-unquote religious belief and using it. And then I also enjoyed the portion where he spoke about how the Africans understood what the Europeans were doing without having studied European philosophy. They saw that these people were consuming. They were parasites. He uses this word, and I love it, and I want to start using it on a daily basis to describe white people as a parasite, and their negatively parasitic relationship with Africans, that their ships would come, and these people were just so greedy, and they couldn't get enough. And I love the descriptive word he uses, gorge, and how the Africans at their core understood this because they had that concept within their complex religious beliefs, and they even applied that to their own. I believe that this chapter has given me, as a victim, so much more clarity on the dangers of white belief systems and how every belief system that is expounded by white people, whether it be anti-sexual, whether it be environmental, whether it be when it comes to economic policies or beliefs, every policy expounded by white people is infected by this virus of their way of thinking, and how these quote-unquote primitive people captured that very quickly. So to me, those are very impactful portions. But again, it's been a challenge to read this book because my comprehension, this has obviously proved that my comprehension is I have a very difficult time grasping concepts, and but I like the challenge. Thank you.
Right on. Brain computer will get stronger as we go, I suspect. All of us. Other folks who dialed in who have a hand up, if you had commentary, your line should be open. Feel free.
Can I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to comment about, number one, I didn't know that this book was accepted as part of the literary canon for gender and queer theories, a theoretical perspective, but I understand why and how that this could be a book that be praised by academia and the institution as being constructive. I mean, it's constructive for us in the context of racism and discrimination and how we talk about it, but I can see why they would like it, primarily because it doesn't appear to be outright condemning white people. in white behavior. And I think it's, you know, stating very constructive information, but sometimes, especially as a victim, I speak for myself, having a thread that kind of weaves it all together to say this is why it's so terrible, this is what negative has happened, this is why we are, you know, something like that, that kind of brings it together. And that might happen later on in the book, but I can see it as just, you know, like when it's historical, it's like, okay, and that leaves a lot of room, in my opinion, for white people to say, well, that was then, that's not us now, you know, and all that kind of stuff. And that brings me to the second thing that I was thinking about, is in listening to the Malcolm X book and podcast, excuse me, there was some, I think it might have even been you that she said that, I think it's niggardly or niggerish, like our thinking is very small, like when, like our concepts, that we lack imagination. I think Malcolm X mentioned that, that's part of the problem with so-called black leaders, that we lack imagination. And I think that might be true. The more information that we get, the more we can see things. But even like if we were to take a book like this and understanding what we are beginning to understand about white people and how we as victims have been conditioned, how they've done that with this just raping of young black boys and young black girls and black men and black women, non-white people, and this just overall rape, being able to think of what do we do about the problem. I don't know, like, when you know that, it's kind of hard to say, well, we should just work within the system or something like that. Because I think when we lack information, when we don't just make decisive decisions about them, come to conclusions about them, it makes it harder for us to figure out what to do about them and what to do just in general. And that was something that I was thinking as I was listening to this, because I think they're the same people. I don't think anything has happened to psychologically undo what is, I think, at this point, like, I would just say that it's, like, maybe psychologically genetic. So how do we know, you know what I mean? If that's any different, maybe it's only, you know, artificial laws that keep that at bay. It's even that, because it still happens now. And there was something else, but I'm kind of forgetting. So if there's time later, I'll jump in. Thank you.
I don't want. Other folks who dialed in, who have a hand up, do y'all have commentary? Other folks?
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you very much, Gus. Another thing that the book made me think about, especially when they were discussing the kidnapping of Africans from West Africa going further west to America, and this is something that I believe comes up in Sankofa, is the fact that Africans, traditional indigenous Africans, always thought that the West was the land of the dead. So when they were being kidnapped and never being seen again, in some cases they assumed that they were just taken to the world of the dead and consumed by these ghost spirit people, these white people. So that's just something that came to my mind, because even if you study in Kemet, on the west is where they would bury their dead, and the living would live on the east side of the river. So I just thought that was really poignant. On page 50, Mr. Woodard, he writes, in bringing up the topic of Christianity, Equiano encourages his reader to ponder the interconnections between Christian theological practice and Christian masters such as this, with whom he frequently describes as human butchers, flesh takers, and death dealers. And it made me think just holistically about Christianity, that Christianity is a cannibalistic religion, because when you partake of the body of Jesus, and they give you the cracker in church, and then his blood is symbolically the wine, so you're eating basically Jesus. And then it's also homosexual in the sense that the Protestant religions have removed the mother of God from the entire equation. So you have a son God born of a male God without a mother God. And all of that implies just entire homosexuality. The mother was replaced by a masculine Holy Spirit. So everything about the religion is homosexual. So their psychotic, psychosexual, just tragic, sick behavior is woven into their entire religious complex, as well as the pinnacle of that complex being white supremacy, not the deity itself. So I just find that to be a very important set of sentences that he put together. And also on the following page, he writes, driving this point home, Equiano depicts himself as an enlightened consumer who has learned from the European to imbibe their spirit and imitate their manners. And to me, this just speaks to the indoctrination of Black people into white culture in the form of this twisted sexual behavior, and how they actually indoctrinate them into then perpetuating these things on other people. Because you learn about Equiano's relationship with the indigenous male, and he basically goes through the same process that Dick and Richard basically did to him. So he's been practicing the same techniques on other people, other non-white people, further confusing them. So I find that to be just very important to think about. And it just makes me really look at non-white people, especially Black people, especially those Black people who are homosexual. I feel really like, just in a way, really sorry for them, because to me, I think books like this really bring home the fact that, like, just the sheer number of our people that have now embraced this lifestyle, it just shows that they've done an impeccable job of spreading this psychosis like far and wide, to the point where they're transforming the entire society. And it's now getting to the point where being heterosexual is going to be considered a bad word. That's the direction it's going in. Thank you. And I'll mute my line.
Cleo Monago is rolling over in his grave. Other folks that we have not heard from since the second audio segment concluded. Anybody we have not heard from who had commentary?
Yes, Mayor Beard.
Yes, sir.
Okay, on page 49, in the middle, lad said, again, Shaw notes that persons from Sierra Leone and other regions viewed the slave trade as the European ritual process that integrated the transport of African bodies across the Atlantic into a further set of transactions with the European guard. The people of Niger even applied this notion of deity, deification, and consumptive practice to the slave ship itself, describing it as some object of worship of the white man. And, you know, I thought it was ironic that the new Smithsonian Afro-American Museum here in D.C. was designed as a slave ship. You know, I thought that, you know, symbols were important. We learned that from Dr. Wilson, and I just thought it was an interesting connection, that slave ship concept, because we always use the metaphors of the plantation, you know, and or prison, you know, to describe the environment that non-white Black people live in here, this part of the world. But that slave ship concept should also be considered. And then on page 57, it says to dismiss African observations that Europeans were cannibals as myths and superstition is to miss the very valuable and vital insight into human capacity and immoral potential implied in most indigenous African cosmetologies and esoteric science of human consumption. You know, we just can't underestimate those who classify themselves as white and practice a form of what they call Christianity, but which is actually the religion of white supremacy. And I'll mute my line. Thanks, guys.
Indeed, indeed. Other folks that we have not heard from since the second audio segment concluded. Anybody have commentary?
That's really quick. Who is it that's rolling over in their grave? I don't know that person.
Cleo Monago, he's been a guest on the program, I think at least three different times. He's a Black male, He identifies as same gender loving, meaning he is engaged in what they call sexual activity with other males. He identifies as a black male. He does talk about white supremacy from time to time, but he also, from my observation, and you can hear some of the commentary that he shared on the program, engages in a lot of indicting black people. I think his tagline is that black people, you can't have a rational conversation about homosexual activity with black people, that black people are very irrational about all of this, and name call black gay people. And he talks a lot about that as well. We've talked about it on this program before, but I think he would, some of the commentary that's been given today on this book, I think he would say, see, there it is right there. Can't have a rational conversation with black people. They just come with all this, you know, if you're engaged in homosexual activity, you're violating the black code, and you're not an African if you do this. And he shared a lot of commentary like that. That's why I've been saying he would be, I've been saying he would be rolling over in his grave to suggest that he would be not pleased with some of the commentary that has been shared on the program today.
Oh, I thought he died. I thought you said that because he died. I was
no, like, he's still alive.
Yeah, when I go back away. Jeez, I'm slow. I get tweaking himself, man.
Yes, he's still alive. I do that from time to time as well. I say that for people who are still alive and doing well. He's fine. Not wishing death on Cleo Monago. Just goofy joke by Gus.
For a second, I was thinking, I was like, did he pass away? Like, oh, shit.
Shout out to Cleo Monago, who is not dead. Not dead. Definitely
yes,
not
sir.
Dead.
Shout out.
Thank you.
Did we miss anybody? Everybody good?
I had a question if I could pose to the listening audience and host.
Yes, sir.
My question was, we just spoke about how the Africans understood to some degree what the Europeans were there to do, what white people were there to do. But yet and still, they had no way of stopping it from happening. So it's almost as if their understanding of white supremacy had no effect on it being carried out. I'm really not sure how to interpret that or what that means, as like big picture wise, but I just wanted to get everyone's thoughts if they believe that it was their lack of understanding, because they did understand the Europeans were there to consume them, but they could not stop them from doing any of that.
Can I answer that, Gus?
Oh, sure. I'm sure. I mean, hopefully, we'll have time if more than one person wants to share their thoughts. I would just say the problem would seem to be that certainly not enough black people understood. Even going from the text this week, not enough black people understood. And then also, a problem would seem to be that that understanding could be broken, as was the case with Alado Equiano, where it seemed from his text and what we covered this week and last week that he did understand them as enemies and cannibals, but that suspicion was broken eventually. And that happens a lot with black people too. So I think those are part of the problem. I certainly think at some points you do have black people where they understand, but they're still overpowered. There's still such a massive power differential that is a problem too. But I still think a huge aspect is we have never, I think, had a large enough number of black people who understand this is what it means to be white. They're enemies. This is eternal. There's no talking, compromising, none of that. And we're going to have to organize our behavior to put them out of business. I just don't think the case has ever been that enough black people, non-white people on the planet have had and properly implemented that understanding.
That's the reason this show is so important, Gus. And I thank you, to the heavens for this show. I just wanted to speak to to the question as well. When Olaudah Equiano discusses the fact that he says that that white people were superior, I think that psychology, the main thing I think for the indigenous people and white people and Arabs for that matter came into the continent was the fact that our spirituality was so high that we started to become lax in our military prowess in regards to the types of weapons that we had. So when we encountered these more savage people with more savage and deadly weapons, we did not have a means to combat that. And then once they did use the science of military science in the form of these guns and cannons, they convinced the indigenous people that they had more power than them. And once you cave in psychologically to the idea that your enemy is more powerful than you, they started to believe that they were also favored by whatever deity they worshipped over the Africans being favored by their deity and deities that they worshipped and venerated. So once that conquering took place psychologically and you realized that the power that they had lie in the fact that they were brutal, they had no limits to their brutality, and they also had the weaponry to back it up, I think a lot of people just caved in and said, you know what, we're going to have to try and make the best way possible in a situation that's impossible because we cannot overcome them. And then couple that with what Gus said, the fact that very few people understood exactly who and what they were dealing with. And then white people inculcated secrets, keeping their secrets. And that has been an intergenerational perpetuation. And I think that leads to a lot of, this text speaks a lot to that. Thank you.
Before we wrap, if anybody else wants to respond to that or any other quick comments they want to get in, we should have time for that as well. I just wanted to share a few of the things that I jotted down, notes I took as we were moving through the second audio segment. Let's see. I thought it was significant where it says, in the context of such occurrences, talking about this consumption of black flesh, where Equiano was calling whites human butchers, it says, within this context, white men experienced a sense of deific power. Furthermore, Equiano makes a point of emphasizing that the master takes pleasure in this and other torturous activities to which he has clearly given much thought. I thought that was so important because that is a huge component of white culture. That's the same sort of thing that you see today. Daniel Holzclaw, the officer who was convicted serial rapist in Oklahoma City, raping exclusively black females, taking pleasure in these sort of activities. I remember Officer Justin Volpe in New York. He sodomized anally Abner Louima back in the 90s. He is reported to have ran around the police station after anally raping this black male, ran around the police station with the plunger in hand, proud of what he had accomplished. In my opinion, both Holzclaw, Justin Volpe, white culture, you're supposed to be a god. That's what deific means, that literally I can decide whether this person lives or dies. You know, we can carve this person up right now, chop their fingers off, and anything else, any other tortures that we think of in the next 5 minutes, we could do it right now. That sort of power that racist man, racist woman, racist child have wielded over our lives for centuries. I mean, they absolutely narcissistic racist supply that I mentioned last audio segment. Let's see. This is next page. He says, the state of pleasure that Equiano describes connotes horror, objection, and human vampirism. In this context of social death and energetic explain, pleasure operates as one, an organic unit, a life-sustaining energy readily bartered and exchanged during slavery. I would say during racism, white supremacy, I'd say that might even be a great definition for narcissistic supply, racist supply. Number two, a process of internalizing and imbibing spirit and soul force. And then he goes on to Orlando Patterson's Rituals of Blood, which I would like to check out myself. But I mean, that is the system of white supremacy. That is leaving a black body out in the street for 4 hours, deriving pleasure and literally internalizing, imbibing the spirit and soul force. That's mocking the corpse of Trayvon Martin, which was done during the 2013 trial for his shooting death. These sorts of things literally consuming black death. The same type of thing I said about Hillary Clinton getting all these black mothers of Trayvon Martin and family members of Michael Brown and Sandra Bland to get them to come and, oh yes, talk about your pain and how when did the black person die? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. How long were they out? And just going, it's the same thing imbibing the spirit and soul force of melanated people. Core aspect of white culture. Next thing. Yeah, I thought there was a great portion. The Gambians getting an accurate understanding of white people. I thought it was significant that pointing out that they had this accurate understanding and did not have all of the highfalutin Western academies and what have you and their know-how, but they still accurately. And I thought it was even great. It reminded me of Yorugu, Dr. Marimba Ani, one of the very first books we did on the book study, where Woodard, he writes, the African-based perspectives of European Christian consumption inverts this logic, honing in on European religiosity, religious ritual, and deity, and self-making as processes based in appetite and human consumption. When the African spoke of Christians as human consumers or of Christianity as a religion based in human consumption, what they were observing and articulating were the Europeans' hungers, appetites, willfulness, glut, greed, and titillation, all operating through an institutionalized context of spirit and soul edification. Africans, we might say, saw through the rhetoric of European spirituality to the real spiritual motivations. I thought that was great. Rhetorical ethic, again, one of Dr. Marimba Ani's just brilliant concepts. I think getting right to the point, we see through all this nonsense, this is the religion of white supremacy, and you all just making justifications to terrorize us and carry out your religion, which at its core is about abusing black people, abusing and killing black people. I was speechless for a moment. The next page, when they were talking about this, Mr. Drummond in the Caribbean, and when it said that he owned over 41,000 slaves, and I was just kind of reading by, and then I stopped. I said, "Whoa, 41,000! Like, good God, that is, I mean, wow! There are towns that are not population 41,000. That is just massive amount of black people to rape, pillage, torture. I mean, wow." Continuing, let's see. Anything else I want to make sure I get in before I pause? If anybody else wants to respond to the question or anything else they need to get in, let's see. Last note. Where the portion where he says, I'll include the quote from Equiano. What saves Equiano from the fate of the common slave is his acknowledged difference. One master, he relates, said he did not mean to treat me as a common slave. I told him I knew something of seamanship and could shave and dress hair pretty well, and I could refine wines, which I had learned shipboard where I had often done it. By this point in the narrative, after his introduction to the new, more brutal form of slavery, Equiano understands well that only his usefulness and closer social proximity to affluent whites saves him from the consumptive fate of the common slave. And he's still being consumed, abused all the way. It's just trying to mitigate. I think this, it even reminds me of, if people remember this time last year, we were reading Edward Baptist, The Half Has Never Been Told. And I remember one of the points I raised was that he used language to suggest that black females exclusively, that they were, I think the word he used was leverage their sexuality to curry maybe better treatment from white enslavers who might be sexually attracted to them as black females. And I question whether that was an act of racism, him even suggesting that sort of possibility. Why I say that that is total nonsense, because when you're in this type of situation as described by Equiano, you are vulnerable. You have so much less power. Consent is out of the window. It's whatever. I'm going to do whatever I have to do to eat, to survive, to not end up like the common Negroes who are doing God knows what. That's how you have so many black people, even to present day 2017, who can be easily manipulated to do anything, even to, and I'm put this in quote, consenting to being raped because of the alternatives of what could happen to you under a system of white terrorism. Human butchers. I'll stop there. Soul butcherers as well. I'll stop there. Anybody else have commentary they wanted to get in before we conclude, or to respond even to the question that was asked about whether or not black people were well informed enough to stop white terrorism?
Gus, I'd like to ask the question before we sign off, if you would repeat that book again, the one with dark in the title.
Yes, sir. That is Dark Places of the Earth, The Voyage of the Slave Ship Antelope. And it's written by Jonathan M. Bryant.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Published in 2015. It's a pretty new book. Any other comments folks want to get in? Everyone satisfied? I will assume folks are good. We'll be here tomorrow. Compensatory call-in, 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. Looking forward to catching up on the past week, first week of Black History Month, catching up on news and observations. I think we'll be doing our Sunday broadcast. I know it's the big game. And in fact, related to this text, I think we're going to rebroadcast when Dr. Welsing visited. And we pretty much spent the bulk of the broadcast talking about Jeffrey Dahmer, Jerry Sandusky, and these white males, the aspect of white culture involving sexual rape of children and consumption of black bodies. That program, I had been going back. I think that was one of the remaining interviews that we did with Dr. Welsing that I had to get back in the archives. It is there, and it was done 5 years ago on Dr. King's holiday in 2012. I was going to play it because it would have been 5 years to the day on the King holiday this year, but we had a different broadcast that day. So we will do it for the Super Bowl. Dr. Welsing, she did numerous visits to the cows over the years on during the actual Super Bowl game. So I thought it would be great to hear her voice once again during the big ball game. And folks that are reading this text probably will get some great information to keep in mind as we are still in the very early stages of The Delectable Negro. We'll pick up next Friday on Chapter 2. That said, thanks everyone for tuning in. I hope it was a constructive investment of your Friday evening. If you have any commentary you would like to write in to add to the book as we go, feel free, just drop an email, untiljustice@gmail.com. We'll state again, this is listener-supported counter-racist radio. Invest if you think the program is constructive. racism-notes.blogspot.com. racism-notes.blogspot.com. When you hit the blog, PayPal button is in the top right corner. If you're not into PayPal, drop us an email and we will get you a physical mailing address. Huge thanks to all the folks who have invested, supported down through the years. Almost 8 years, our anniversary later this month. Hope the cows has been, continues to be worthy of your time and energy. I will state again, as it is the weekend, sobriety would be best under conditions of white terrorism. I was speaking with victims of racism yesterday, and they were giving an anecdote about being jumped by some white people, and they noted that white people and alcohol were a component of the story. And when I mentioned what I say here, every time we end, sobriety would be best, they noted, I think all of the times that I've had any sort of fight or conflict since I've been an adult, white people and alcohol were present. Not a coincidence. Anytime you see white people and alcohol, you want to be on the highest alert, and I would even say really make an effort to minimize how frequently you are in those environments, particularly with this climate. Things could go bad, and I mean real quick, and that was also an element to the stories that were shared. Things going bad very, very quick, and I mean in a matter of seconds, it goes from everything is calm to people are bleeding, police are being called, things, I mean, just total chaos in a matter of seconds. Alcohol, whites, always a horrendous combination. Sobriety would be best under conditions of white terrorism. That said, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, brother.
A victim. I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.